brothers are our last hope to save the world.
Cool. No, not cool.
A bit cool.
You can't stop us.
What?
Ice Cube, John Cena, Seth Rogen.
What you looking at, bro?
Yeah, bro, what you looking at?
Jackie Chan, Rose Byrne, Post Malone, Maya Rudolph, and Paul Rudd.
I like his vibe.
I like your vibe.
I like your vibe.
I like your vibe.
Now playing in theaters. Rated PG.
All right, everybody ready? Go!
Thursdays and Sundays on CBS.
Buckle up, because it's going to be a long season.
The battle is on as CBS reality titans.
We are the strongest force in this game.
Team up with MTV Challenge legends.
People are coming for blood, and it's going to get ugly.
Who will become?
What y'all are very good at is lying to people's faces.
America's Challenge champion.
The Challenge USA, new Thursdays and Sundays on CBS.
I'm kind of like an animal that looks for his prey. I am the toughest opponent that he has ever faced.
Back with a vengeance. It will be one heck of a night. We start in the welterweight division. Trayvon Marshall takes on Gabrielle Maestre, the co-main. The battle of unbeaten. Gary Antoine Russell taking on Kent Cruz. And then, of course, the capper. The main event for the IBF bantamweight title. Emmanuel Rodriguez taking on Melvin Lopez.
This is a hurt business. Someone old got to go.
I love fighting southpaws. I'm going to shock the world, man.
Back in my hometown, it's almost like I'm representing my area.
I think it's going to bring the best out of me. I feel like he got more pressure than me.
Pressure make diamonds.
He wants it. I want it. We are going to just throw for the world title. He may have the 7 stoppages, but none of those 7 were me. Talking is cheap. I'm going to prove why I can be one of the best at 180. I guarantee you that I'm going to come out with the win. It will be sending a message to the other champions of the division that I'm here to stay.
Our official weigh-in for tomorrow's exciting night of boxing. 146.6 for El Capitan. 146.8 for Marshall. 142.6 for Cruz. 138.4 for Russell. This is our co-main event. 117 for Lopez. 118 for Rodriguez. We have a world championship bout. Live on Showtime.
From the land of half smokes and go-go music, welcome everyone inside the MGM National Harbor right here in Washington, D.C., technically Oxon Hill, Maryland, just on the other side of the water. Here we are for Showtime Boxing Countdown. I'll be your host for today's festivities. My name is Luke Thomas, joined by just one of the brightest minds in all of boxing. And if you don't follow him on Twitter, I mean, what are you doing? It's Stephen Breadman Edwards. Hi, Stephen. How are you?
Hey, how you doing? Thanks for having me.
Yeah, man, we're glad to be here. So here's how this is going to go this evening. We've got 3 fights for you on the prelim card. Stephen and I will be calling those and having some fun discussions the whole way through. And, of course, starting at 9 p.m. in the East, a 3-fight main card headlined, Stephen, by a 118-pound bantamweight IBF clash for the vacant IBF title, I should say, between Emmanuel Rodriguez and, of course, Melvin Lopez. Rodriguez has been in this position before. Hello, he was the champion here, of course, before fighting Noya Inoue. Inoue won that one inside the 2nd round, but has vacated the titles as he's moved up. But for a guy like Rodriguez, having already been champion, what does that mean? This is like a second chance, like he knows what to do here. What kind of mindset do you think he's got, having already been a champion in this weight class before?
You know, a lot of times when a guy's been a champion already, he has that, like, been there, done that type of mentality. You know, nothing's going to rattle him because he's already walked down that road. So Rodriguez is a veteran. He's been around. He should be fine with that kind of stuff.
It's going to be a fun fight, too, right? A guy like Rodriguez, what would you call him? A counterpuncher? A clever counterpuncher? Because it's funny, Lopez has described himself that way, but I think if you look at the tape on him, he's a little bit more of a come-forward, aggressive type. It might be a bit of a tough fight if you do that kind of thing to Rodriguez.
You know, I saw Rodriguez fight Gary Antonio Russell, and that was one of the most clever counterpunching displays I've seen in a long time. He could not miss his right hand that night. It was like zeroed in on, I think this, because the stoppage was a little bit controversial,
yes,
he didn't get credit for the performance, but he did great that night. So I'm curious to see if Lopez is going to want to lead on him, because He looked like a master counterpuncher that night, man. That was an excellent performance.
He certainly did. Of course, those guys fought twice, both fights ending via head clash, the second of which, though, went long enough where they were able to go to the scorecards. And he was widely up at that time. He had dropped him, I believe, at least two times.
Oh, man. He hurt him about four or five times. And he just put on, he just couldn't miss him. It was like he just knew everything he was going to do before he did it. Antonio Russell showed a lot of heart just not getting stopped that night. I mean, he took some brutal shots.
Now, also on this main card, again, this will be the live Showtime card starting at 9 p.m. You can't come to Prince George's County, Maryland, and not put a Russell brother on the card. So, of course, in our co-main event, Gary Antoine Russell taking on a gentleman who is also undefeated at 16-0-3, but coming off back-to-back draws against the same guy, one split, one majority in Kent Cruz. But Gary Antoine Russell, he can punch, right? He's got big-time power.
Tremendous fighter. Tremendous fighter. Reminds me of a mix of Sean Porter and James Kirkland.
Now, that's an interesting...
Yeah.
Why is that?
When you see a fighter, nobody's an exact replica of a guy, but he just reminds me. He's a southpaw. He's really aggressive, but he has the pedigree that Porter had, but he's not like a smooth, fancy boxer. He's, like, athletic, but he's rough with it. He's a hell of a fighter, man. I thought he would be world champion by now, actually. He can fight.
Well, tonight might be one more step on that journey. Now, of course, as I mentioned, we do have a prelim card to get going here. We're just minutes away. Our first bout of the evening, Damian Vazquez taking on Jeronel Borez. This is going to be an interesting contest, a bantamweight affair, 8 rounds scheduled here. We'll get that going in just a minute, but also we should tell folks, Jose Benavidez Jr. will be on tonight's prelims broadcast here on Showtime Boxing Countdown, his first fight since the Danny Garcia fight, except this time he's now up a weight class himself, coming in at middleweight for this contest, although, Stephen, weighing in at just 158 and some change, I don't think it's a permanent move.
Who knows, you know, 158 is not the same as 154. But a lot of times in this era, these guys are just cutting the water weight. So maybe 4 pounds is no big deal to them.
Did you see the third Apollo movie and Benavidez being Felix Chavez? Did you see that?
I did.
He actually did a pretty good job.
I did. Yep.
Right?
He did. He did an excellent job.
You never know when an athlete who's never done it before how that's going to go. But I felt like he did a respectable effort in the end.
Look at Vasquez's corner. He has Joel Casamayor and Mark Two Sharp Johnson in his corner.
A DC legend.
That's
Mark
a star
Two Sharp Johnson.
Studded corner right
I one
there.
Time was hosting a radio show here. This is a hometown game for me. I've been a lifelong DC resident. And Mark Two Sharp Johnson just called in randomly one day and wanted to talk. One of the highlights of my radio career. All right, we're about to get started here. 8 round scheduled. Damian Vazquez taking on Jeronel Borez, 118 pounds. Vazquez out of Las Vegas, 26 years old, Borez, 28. And as you can tell, Borez in the white trunks, Vazquez in the green.
Vazquez, I see why he brought Casamayor and Mark Johnson into his camp. He's a southpaw, so he's probably getting a lot of tips from those guys on how to navigate around the ring as a southpaw.
Boy, it got quiet as a church mouse in here all of a sudden, huh?
Yeah, it did. Perez is moving pretty good. He has good movement.
The tape on him from what I saw, Stephen, was he was athletic, but tends to get hit a little bit by virtue of maybe too much movement over time that isn't quite as strategic maybe as it could be.
Well, I can tell you right now, Luke, he's better than his record.
His record, of course, currently at 12-8-2, 6 KOs. Vazquez at 16-3-1 with 9 KOs.
Yeah, Borez is a lot better than this record. He's athletic. You can tell he's real comfortable in the ring.
Now, of course, whenever you have southpaw orthodox, as you know much better than I, lead inside foot positioning or outside foot positioning with the lead foot is a critical battle. Also, speaking of Gary Antoine Russell, I should say Gary Antonio Russell, head clashes can be a thing when you get opposite stance like this. So something to pay attention to as the fight progresses.
Yep.
Big swing, right? Kind of overcommitting there.
Flowers.
What are you looking for right now?
Vasquez is the slower fighter, so he should be jabbing, trying to break up the rhythm of Perez. He's not jabbing enough. He's kind of just pawing, trying to like catch up to him, but he's a step behind him in my opinion right now. He should be trying to jab and break up his rhythm so he can't. Perez is like jumping in with fast shots, but he wouldn't be able to do that if Vasquez would just simply just put a real jab on him. He's following him around, but he's not doing much. He's just following him.
Should he be cutting off the ring?
Well, he should establish his jab before he does anything.
Okay.
See, he's trying to, but he's just like walking in, right. and the other guy is significantly quicker than he is.
And now both have gone southpaw.
Good shot, Perez.
All right, first round in the books.
Thought that was a good round for Perez.
Yeah, a bit of a feel-out round in either direction here. Neither guy trying a whole lot, but as you can see, Perez, despite the record, athletic, quick.
Yeah, he is.
Seems to understand his assignment, yep. His fight style, leans yep. into it. Not going to be a walkthrough, despite maybe what the odds makers think here.
You know what they say, you don't fight the record, you fight the man. And he's very capable.
How should people view someone's record? I mean, Bill Parcells was like, you are what your record says you are. But you're trying to say that maybe not, right?
It depends. I know some guys with funny records that can fight. I mean, we had a guy out of Philadelphia by the name of Freddie Pendleton. I think he won the world lightweight title with, like, maybe 19 losses. It depends. You know, everybody doesn't have the matchmaking or the management, you know, and they're forced to take certain fights at certain points of their career. I like to look at the record and then examine the guys that they fought, how they lost. If you have a bunch of split decisions, losses in another guy's hometown, you know, you got to be able to take that in context.
You got to grade them on a curve?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I don't know the ins and outs. I didn't, you know, forensically examine Perez's record, but he can fight. He's very athletic. He's quick. Knows his way around the ring. He's much better than his record indicates. Maybe he has conditioning issues. Who knows? We'll see as the fight goes on.
Neither guy landing anything of significance yet.
Whoa, good shot. Good sneaky
hard
shot.
Hard left hook.
Good sneaky shot.
Yeah, hard left hook from Perez rattles Vasquez.
Yep, good sneaky shot. Luke Perez is like dropping his head down and he's looping shots over the top that Vasquez is not seeing. That hook he'd never even seen. He's been trying to hit him with a right hand all night from over the top.
Good uppercut as he came around the corner there from Vasquez.
Yep. Even though Vasquez is taller, he needs to close the distance and get a little bit closer to this guy because the guy's reflexes is a little better than his from the outside.
You can hear his corner, the corner of Perez, telling him to jab and go left. So far, being unable to do that.
He just landed a good jab right there.
Okay. I mean, you know what I'm saying.
Yep. Yep.
Huge swing there. Got to be careful with those.
One thing I noticed about Perez, he looks a little bit fatigued already. So that may be why his record is a little bit funny. He may have conditioning issues. But he definitely has a talented fighter.
Both guys still filling each other out here a little bit through round two, about a minute left. Vasquez spending a little bit of time going to the body, right?
That's a smart thing. You got to slow this guy down. He's a little quicker than he is.
I've done this before with Boots Ennis, and I asked him what his number one strategy for a fighter who moves a lot, who's quick. He was like, roast the ribs, cook them.
He's a tremendous body puncher. I've caught pads with him, and that kid can really punch.
How was that, holding the pads?
He's electric. He's electric. I've been on him for years. I used to have him in camps with my guys. Ever since he was about 17 years old, he's a phenomenal fighter.
We'll talk a little bit more about that when we get a break, because there's obviously some conversations. We're still in the halo of Spence Crawford. and everything that meant for boxing and for the welterweight division. Boots, obviously a key player in that, and a Philly fighter, right?
Yep, he is.
Two rounds in the books here. Showtime Boxing Countdown. Damian Vasquez taking on Borez. What would you say? Vasquez got rocked a little bit, but had his own kind of comeback moment. I do think he's landing overall the steadier work, if not the overall more significant.
I thought Borez won the first round and Vasquez won the second one.
All right, so it might be split between two. Yep. And again, we're only headed for eight in this particular context. So we'll see how that goes. And by the way, both guys still in their 20s. As I mentioned, Vasquez, 26 years old, Borez, 28.
In between rounds, I like to see the temperament of the corners and see if I could pick up on anything that the corners are saying and, you know, their energy over there.
What'd you get?
I didn't really get to see much right now. I couldn't really hear too much.
All right, round three, excuse me. Here in this bantamweight affair from Oxon Hill, Maryland. I moved to Oxon Hill, Maryland in December of 2004 from New York City. That was a tough move, let me tell you. They are not the same, but nevertheless, nice shot.
See the overhand shots? He drops his head down and he loops him over. Vasquez is not seeing almost a head clash right there.
Not that I'm comparing them in totalizing ways, but that's a little bit of the Isak Cruz method. Dropping his head, coming over the top, landing.
Yeah, different kind of fighters, but you're right.
For sure.
Fighter from Philadelphia does that really good. Danny Garcia, he'll drop his head down and the opponent will follow his head with their eyes and he'll loop shots over. You never see the shots coming over. He hits you with left hands, left hooks and overhand rights all the time with that move. Danny's actually an expert at it.
You have to really sell them with your eyes, right? Like, that's the key. That's the whole part of the salesmanship.
Well, what happens, Luke, is the guy, he follows your head with his eyes.
Right.
So you'll drop your head down, but you'll loop the shot over and hit, and the shot will come out of his line of sight because he's looking at your head and he's not paying attention to where your arms are. If you notice, Danny Garcia, he clips guys with that all the time. He'll drop his head down and wing a left hook, and you'll be looking at his head, and the left hook will come slap you right on your temple and knock you out.
And in fact, speaking of Danny Garcia, his last opponent, Jose Benavidez Jr., will be in the next fight that we're calling. Big change to go from Danny Garcia to Sladan Yanyanin, but this is where Jose Benavidez Jr. finds himself today.
He's on the comeback trail.
He looked quite menacing in the hallway when we both entered at the same time to get in here. Seemed ready. Seemed to be in good shape, too. About under a minute left for round three, Vasquez Borez. Borez tricky, but Vasquez steady. Do you think Borez has a lot of wasted movement?
I think.
He doesn't have an economical movement style, right?
You know what? I don't want to say it's wasted. But I do think he will open a shot. We'll only know if he's wasted if he runs out of gas. I think that he has to move like that though, Luke, because he's a shorter guy. He can't really like hold the center of the ring and have a commanding jab and kind of dominate him with his jab. So he has to, you know, move and do a lot of little trick stuff. Because you can tell there's a significant size difference between him. And Vasquez.
And here at the end of the round, you saw Vasquez able to corner Borez, and he did his best work there. Mm-hmm. Right hand to the liver, left uppercut came through, and it looks to me like we're getting a slow, you kind of indicated it in round two. Now that round three's done, we can look at the replay here. He's kind of showboating, putting his hands behind him, and that one landed. That's a nice shot for him to be able to do that, not just his head being a different target, but kind of hiding the hand there a little bit. Nevertheless, you can begin to see Vasquez able to corner him a little bit more easily as each round begins to expire.
He's more consistent with his work. Vasquez is more consistent, but Borez is throwing the flashier shot. So it may come down to what the judges appreciate and what they like.
Are you one of the guys who like, what's your view on people standing between rounds, fighters standing between rounds?
you know, I don't have a some guys don't like to get up and sit down because they think it takes their legs away. You know, in the gym, they're standing all the time. So I don't think it's a big deal. But, you know, it depends on what the fighter's comfortable doing.
All right, round four here in this bantamweight affair between Damian Vasquez and Jeraneel Borez out of the Philippines.
Vasquez is starting to try to establish his jab a little bit. Ooh, good straight left hand.
Set up off that jab, too,
yep.
Off the angle change.
He's starting to try to find his jab a little bit.
Combination attack there from Borez doesn't go anywhere. That's his spot right there, right? Pushing him to the ropes, going yep. to the body?
Yep. Straight left hand to the body should do him some justice once he goes to the ropes.
What about this fencing battle, the battle of the lead hands? Oh, good left hand uppercut to the body from Vasquez.
It lifted him off the canvas. I don't think they're fencing too much, though, Luke. I think that Perez is not really using his jab. He's just trying to land a bunch of sucker punches and navigate around the ring and pot shot here and there. Vasquez is the one that's trying to establish his jab at this point.
Man, every time he can get nice combination from Perez. I was just going to say that once he can get him to freeze, that's when Vasquez is able to do a little bit of the better work.
Borez has those quick hands and those flashy combinations, so he keeps reminding the judges that he's in it with these fast combinations every few moments. You see, he'll run his hands every few moments just to let them know that he's still here. That's the kind of fight that's a little bit more difficult to score than people realize.
How much do you ever train a fighter? I mean, what's the line between I'm legitimately trying to beat this guy or put him away versus okay, I need to look active and do something that the judges value.
You know, I tell fighters all the time that, you know, it's not just about winning. It's making the judges believe that you're winning. It's your presentation. You know, it's like going to court. You know, when they say you're, guilty or not guilty. You know, there's people who have been found not guilty that were really guilty, but they had good presentation. You know, so a guy needs to know how to command the ring. It's a lot that goes into that, you know, and Perez is trying to, I don't usually like to use the word steal rounds, but what he's trying to do, he's not working as much as Vasquez, but every once in a blue moon, he'll land a nice combination or a big punch to kind of make it, you know, the fight look more competitive.
And you can see the game plan here mm-hmm. through four.
Mm-hmm.
If Vasquez can corral him mm-hmm. and corner him and there's nowhere for him to go, he could begin to light him up on the inside. But if there's space and he's got room and or timing, it's a Borez kind of fight.
Yep.
Here's the replay right here.
Yep.
Those look he that runs into shot. That left
yep.
uppercut to the body, frames him with a high elbow. But then look at the hand combination
yep.
there.
Yep.
From Borez. Good work by both gentlemen there in that last frame.
I can see this fight being a tough fight to score.
Have you ever been able to talk to a judge about how and why they scored any particular fight or round the way they did?
No, I don't think we're supposed to talk to judges.
No? Oh, I've done it. I've done it.
No, I'm talking about as a trainer.
Oh, as a trainer, okay.
Yeah, but I do notice that the judge is closest to me during the fight. He usually favors my guy because he hears me talking my guy through the fight. So the judge close to me, I usually have that particular judge. Believe it or not, I'll see which guy was next to me and often they're more on our side than the judges on the far part of the ring because he can hear me saying good shot and things like that throughout the fight.
Now, how much of that is directly intentional? Not to so much motivate your fighter, but so that I'm going to do this so that the judge absolutely hears me.
Both. It's directly intentional and I'm trying to motivate my fighter. But the judges are human beings. They have ears. They hear the crowd and they hear different things.
Here we are, round five in this 118-pound affair. And it looks to me like the movement of Borez has slowed demonstrably.
Mm-hmm. Borez is at a point now where he's calmed down. He's, he, for the way he fights, he's going to need to land something big to kind of stop Vasquez from snowballing.
And Borja is literally turning away there for a moment. That could have been ugly. He's got kind of that up flick jab. There's that combination. He runs into it. Vasquez wiser about it. Nevertheless, a right hand from Borges scores on the clinch break. One thing that I often just sort of say in contests like this, where they're not necessarily scoring a ton of very memorable strikes, is just the guy who's doing more work.
Yes, and right now that guy is Vasquez.
Yeah, no doubt about it. You can just literally outwork a guy.
Yep. Vasquez can make this fight easier, though, if he would go to the body.
With the jab?
No, straight left hand, right to the solar plexus.
Yeah, he's doing some of the body work, but only in close once he's got him trapped. Yep.
Double jab and straight left hand right to the solar plexus. See, we just double jabbed him? Because when he double jabs, Perez goes straight back.
Neither guy necessarily a dominant puncher. As I mentioned, 9 KOs for Vasquez, 6 for Borges.
Do you notice how Borges's left hand, good shot by Perez. Vasquez's left hand is going over Perez's head. If he would just shoot it a little bit lower, he'd be able to get it in there.
Almost a bit of a collar tie punch.
I think it was a low blow.
A bit of a low blow, yeah. I was just going to say. Referee, I guess, has called time. No, clock stopped. Just 12 seconds left in the frame, according to our unofficial timer. Yeah, this is that tie-up that they get into. It's where Vasquez does his best work. Through 5 rounds.
You know something, Luke? Right now, Perez's body language is starting to look a little bit poor. It's starting to drop off a little bit. And that's one of the things about the presentation with the judges. You don't want the judges to see you even look tired. If you start looking tired or looking like you're laboring, they'll start scoring rounds against you even if you're not getting beat up. So, you know, Perez has to be conscious of his body language. His body's getting a little slopey and he's falling around.
A little loose, right?
You got it. And the judges pick up on that. And what they'll do is they'll think that Vasquez is wearing him down and he's having a bigger effect than what he may really is not even having. You know, so your body language is real important in a fight.
I'm really glad we have a referee who wears the latex gloves. This is something we talked about pre-fight. I cannot stand it when boxing referees don't do that.
It's your pet peeve.
Drives me insane. All right, here we go. Round 6. In our opening bout here on Showtime Boxing Countdown, we have 2 more fights for you after this. And again, Jose Benavidez Jr. will be next.
Vasquez started this round really fast.
Good body shot, too. Not quite the double jab left hand, but it got through.
Good shot right there. He's working this round.
And it looks to me like Vasquez is not really afraid of being hit back right now. Before, he had a little bit more trepidation about the power of Borges. He just seems to be walking through it.
You know why, Luke? Because look at Borges' body language. When you see a guy like that in front of you, it spurs you on. It galvanizes you. It makes you, you know, makes you think you're doing something. You know, body language is really, really important in fights.
And boy, you were right, Steven. Here comes Vasquez. Absolutely. Yeah,
you can tell he got a little second wind now. He's rolling now.
He squared up on him for just a moment there.
He's putting a lot of pressure on him now. Perez is going to need a big shot to kind of turn the momentum around at this point.
There's nothing he's doing right at the moment that's getting Vasquez off of him.
He can't get him off of him. He needs a real big shot.
Yeah, Vasquez really pushing him around here, bullying him with his shoulder.
This landed a good right uppercut on the inside.
Yeah, Borges not throwing back now. Oh, there it is. Finally, he has a flurry. But he's starting to get worked like a summer job here in round 6. And down goes Borges.
You can see him just wearing out slowly but surely.
Vasquez knew he had Borges hurt or at least tired. Borges answers the count. Let's see if the referee allows to continue. She does. But a huge moment for Damian Vasquez. And he goes right back to work, Steven.
Yeah, he got a serious second win at the beginning of this round. You can see his body language. He just came out and just went for it. Oh, good shot.
Good left straight. Almost left sends hand. Borges through the ropes. He's down for the second time in round six.
Straight left hand down the pipe.
You were calling for it earlier. There it was. Referee's going to let it go. Borges has horrible body language.
I think Borges' corner is thinking about stopping the fight. They're standing up over here.
With a towel in their hand.
Yep. Borges, he's game, though. He's trying to fight him off.
10 seconds to the end of the round. It looks like he's going to make it.
Oh.
Oh, he goes down a third time off a left hand. Nice. Referee's going to give him the count. If he can answer it, he will be able to go back to
his... She
waves it. And that is it, ladies and gentlemen. Damian Vasquez out of Las Vegas, Nevada. He gets the job done with a 6-round stoppage in our opening bout here on Showtime Boxing Countdown. You know what? He took his time. A patient performance, I would say, from Vasquez.
Yeah, he did. Because Perez, you know, he may have an upside-down record, but he's a talented guy. You know, he can fight a little bit. So that was impressive.
Took his time, drained him a little bit.
Yep, that's what he did.
And then when the fight was wide open,
yep.
And then he took it from there?
Yep, kept the steady pressure on him. He wore him out. Okay. I was saying earlier in the fight that Borges must have stamina issues because he's talented.
Yeah.
You can see that he can fight a little bit, but he just don't have the conditioning.
Sure enough, and here is Vasquez not letting him go, elbow blocking him into the ropes, left hand, sits him down for the second time. And look at this work. Good return there a little bit from Borges. But Vasquez, undeterred, left hand, sits him down yet again. Push off. There it was. Just a 1-2.
Nice shot.
Just nice a 1-2.
Nice and simple, right? Keep it simple.
Borges trying a flurry. Oh, gets opened up for a left hand over the top. And that was basically all she wrote. And the ref waves it there. Wisely, I think. Live to fight another day, yep. Right? No need to continue on that one.
I think his corner was about to...
Two minutes and 57 seconds here. Just at the end of round six. Yeah, great win by Damian Vasquez. His record now improves to 17-3-1 with 10 KOs at 26 years of age. I think the future still could be bright for him.
He definitely has a future. He's a solid, solid fighter.
And for Borges, again, sort of showing why he is selected by promoters, he can offer up a sturdy challenge.
Mm-hmm.
But, again, to the point you had highlighted, the conditioning is really not going to be there against a guy like Vaz. He has to have more than that to be able to get the win.
Well, you can tell he doesn't have the conditioning, Luke, because he looks like he should be able to fight at 112. Look how small he
right.
is and how much loose change he has on his body. So that's right. how you could tell he doesn't have the conditioning.
Loose change. Is that your description for it?
That's what, if you see that with a guy, one of your fighters, and you see an opponent, you can kind of tell what kind of shape they're in. Because if that guy gets in real shape, he can get at a much lower weight than 118.
No doubt about it. Let's reset here for just a moment. Our first fight is done here in the books for Showtime Boxing Countdown. My name is Luke Thomas. I'm one half of the hosting duo for the Showtime-produced podcast, Morning Combat. You know this gentleman, just one of the best folks in all of boxing, one of the brightest minds, I have to say, and really a fun follow on Twitter.
Mm-hmm.
Do you like the back and forth with the boxing community on Twitter?
You know what? I like to put stuff out there, and then I just let them kind of have it. You know, I don't really... enjoy going back and forth unless I got a lot of time. So I'll just say something and then the trolls all want to come out and, say their little stuff. But
it is their hobby horse
on
that platform.
It's all part of the game.
Which I guess we have to call X now. I'm really not going to do that. I'm just going to keep calling it Twitter. I'm sorry. It's really what it is.
Oh, they changed the name?
Yeah, Elon Musk bought it and changed the name. It's supposed to be X now. I don't know if you
know. Oh, wow. I didn't know that.
It's a stupid name. I'm just saying that.
I didn't know that. Yeah. I didn't know that.
All right, let's set up here for just a minute if we can. Of course, 9 p.m. is when the broadcast on Showtime proper goes live. We already talked about it in that main event, the IBF Bantamweight title up for grabs between the former champion in Emmanuel Rodriguez taking on Melvin Lopez. But this was the house kind of that Noya in a way built. Just quickly, if I could, get your thoughts on what he has done in this weight class. And then obviously moving up now beyond that to be Stephen Fulton Jr. I want to know what you think of him as a fighter. And also tell me, what is the maximum limit you think he could move up to and really contend for a belt?
You know, I don't like to tell anybody what they can do and what they can't do because he's amazing. You know, that was one of the – I've been watching Stephen Fulton for the last – 13, 14 years in the gym. He's a remarkable fighter, and I'm still a little bit in shock that in a way was able to perform that well against Fulton. You know, I've seen Fulton in the gym, and I've never seen anybody ever do that.
No, not even close.
I mean, he's a phenomenal fighter. In a way, is he looks like, you know, they obviously they have the Manny Pacquiao comparisons. Personally, I don't think he has the bone density that Manny does. Manny is a bigger man. If you see them stand next to each other, not just the height thing, but just the bone density thing. His legs and his head is a lot bigger.
Okay, but Manny went to what, 140?
He went up to
154 against Margarito, right?
Yeah, but he fought, you know, that fight, I think it was a catchweight of 150. I don't know if in a way can do that. You know, I don't think that that's fair. I think you should just leave Manny where he is. But he looks like he has the frame to be able to fight guys at 126. He was strong at 122.
Okay. What about the 130, 135 range?
I don't know, Luke. I think that might be a stretch.
A little too much?
Yeah, I think that might be a stretch.
There have been some comparisons about what about if he fought Tank Davis at 135. I know it's crazy. It's a huge weight class. Listen, we're talking about theoretical matchups here. Don't crucify me on boxing Twitter. But I am just sort of saying certain special guys power and ability carries far beyond what you would normally consider for other elite boxers.
I wouldn't say he can't, but I think it would be the equivalent of someone asking Tank to fight Terrence Crawford at 147. You know what I mean? I just don't know. I just want to enjoy in a way for what he's doing right now. That's a big hill to climb, you know? I don't know if he wants to do that. You know, Tank's no joke, man. And he started out at 108 to go up to fight Tank at 135. I don't think that's fair, you know?
It doesn't seem like a person should be able to do that,
yeah,
right? That
it
seems
does.
Like insane.
You know, it's like, you know, somebody asking great Sugar Ray Robinson, oh, let me see you go up and fight Joe Lewis, you know what I mean?
Right.
Or, I mean, everybody has a certain limit depending on what size you were born, you know? So, but in a way, he is phenomenal. He's probably the greatest fighter that Japan has ever produced, along with maybe fighting Harada. And he's marked himself, in my opinion, as one of the top 10 bantamweights to ever live. And in my opinion, he's also the all-time great fighter, especially for the lower weights. He's a special fighter, man.
We'll talk more about some of the bigger names in boxing. Let's turn our attention, if we can, to our next prelim bout, which is just moments away from getting started. Jose Benavidez Jr., ladies and gentlemen, is about to lock horns with a gentleman by the name of Zlatan Janjanin. Say that one 10 times fast. Jose Benavidez Jr., I was there at the Barclays Center in Brooklyn for his last bout. It's been about a year. He took on Danny Garcia for Danny's first fight at 154. Now, obviously, there's a drop-off between Danny Garcia and Janjanin, no disrespect. Danny Garcia, of course, is a former world champion.
Two division.
Right, of course. But the point I wanted to make here is, what do you make of this stage of Benavidez's career?
I just think it's a rush-shaking kind of fight, you know. Guys don't want to go into tough fights off a year and a half layoff. So he'll shake a little rust this fight, and then the next thing you know, he'll be back in a big fight with a big name at 54 or 60. What month is this? August, sometime at the beginning of next year. That's just how it works. Just a rust shaker.
And would you want to see him at 160 or back at 154?
You know, his body looks good. I think it depends on who he's fighting. If you move up in weight,
and fight a guy that's been at 160 his whole career and is a big, huge guy. It's a little different if you move up in weight and fight a guy that also moved up in weight. You understand what I'm saying? So if he was to fight, let's say if he was to fight Tony Harrison or Julian Williams at 154, 160, that wouldn't be so bad. But if he was to fight, let's see, the guy Johnny Beck, the champion, top rank.
Oh, yeah, Johnny Beck or however, yes.
Yeah, because that guy started out at 160, so he's a bigger man. Right. So it's a little bit of a difference. So it depends on who he fights.
All right, round one here. As you can see, we are getting going.
His body looks good, though. He doesn't...
No loose change.
Yeah, he looks good at 158.
Here we have, of course, as you can see, with Phoenix written on the trunks, the blue and pink trunks of Benavidez and then Jan Janin in the white and black trunks.
Benavidez just went for a nice left hook to the liver. That's his brother's favorite shot.
Now, the tape on Jan Janin, you're about to see it, it's this. It's a lot of herky-jerky movement, a lot of off-rhythm movement, a lot of overhands, a lot of leaning forward. And he's going to move a lot, which is going to force Benavidez to kind of give chase, at least in the early parts of this 10-round affair.
Good shot from the southpaw stance by Benavidez.
And already going to work, Benavidez on the inside.
Benavidez switched early. That's interesting.
And now back to orthodox, yep.
Oh, he's going for it. That was a good left hand to the body. He got a lot of steam on that.
Good combination punching already from Benavidez, right?
Yep. After Benavidez throws a right uppercut, he torques his body and comes through with a left hook to the body. Whenever he throws a right hand, even if it's a right hand, oh, back of the head.
Ooh, several of those. Jan Janin signaling to the referee what's going on here. Referee now warning Jose Benavidez Jr. David is here, though, in attendance. Yeah, those seem pretty blatant. I'm curious to see if we can get a replay here at the end of the round.
He has to watch that. You don't want to lose a fight like this on disqualification. You see, every time he throws that right uppercut, he comes back with a left hook to the body.
For sure.
You get a lot of leverage because your body's already torqued over there because of the right uppercut. So it allows him to get a lot of leverage on the hook to the body. Every time he throws it, he comes back with a sweeping left hook to the body. His brother does the same exact thing.
It's Canelo had that punch on Jose Cito Lopez.
You got it.
He threw the uppercut and then left hook to the body. Yep.
Triple G used it against Matthew Macklin many years ago and knocked him out up against the ropes.
And as you can see, the uppercut's going to be a potent weapon just for how, look how consistently Jan Janin is sort of hunched over.
Yep.
Switching stance. Here comes Benavidez.
Benavidez is mean tonight. He wants to get this guy out of here. That's good. Fighter should fight mean.
And listen, it's hard to look good against Danny Garcia. It's hard to look good for a guy, in terms of the matchup for Benavidez, it's hard for him against a guy who can move as nimbly as Garcia can for him to shine. This is an opportunity, I was sort of trying to say, for Benavidez to maybe showcase some of what he's good at here tonight.
I don't think that he was expecting Garcia to move the way he did.
Right.
I think Danny shocked some people with his movement in the fight. I think he threw Jose Jr. off a little bit with his movement, to be honest with you.
We can see the replays here, switching stances, finding his opportunities. Again, high elbow blocking, pushing him off to create distance, and then going to the body. I cannot see who's in the corner of Benavidez. Is his brother there?
No, he has assistant trainers and his dad is in the corner, but his dad's back is to us right now. But I could tell that's Jose Sr.
Well, we shall see how this goes. That's an easy round to score.
Very easy.
For Jose Benavidez Jr. Round two here, about to get started in Oxon Hill, Maryland, in an area they call the National Harbor. Just on the other side of the water here from Alexandria, Virginia, and or the Wharf in Southeast D.C. Excuse me, Southwest D.C. The Southeast waterfront would be a little bit different.
He can't miss that right uppercut.
Benavidez?
Yep. Yeah. Looks real good with that shot. He's real comfortable in there. It's just a matter of can he put the right punches together and cut the ring off and get this guy out of here. Good left hook to the body. It was a little bit low, but it was on the other side of the referee, and the referee didn't see it.
And it looks to me, now, Coach, you tell me what if I'm missing here, but part of the stance, which is he's cutting off the movement, and then it creates an opposite side from which to come with a big shot all the way through. So you get to cut off the ring and have a power shot at the same time.
You're talking about when he throws that, like, the right uppercut away?
Yeah.
Yep, yep. And the way Yan is, he bends over so much at the waist, you should sit down. You shouldn't bend down. So his head is coming over his front knee. There should be an imaginary line from your front knee to the ceiling. But his head comes over his knee. Your head should never go over that part. And what's happening is he can't defend his body well.
Okay, interesting that there appears to be some bad blood, at least on the side of Benavidez. He had the rabbit punches earlier, and here, before the referee could fully separate him, and now Jan Janin kind of throwing to the back of the head. A little bit of an undisciplined fight.
Referee's going to have to warn somebody and give him a real stern warning. But Jan Janin is susceptible to body shots because of the way he tries to sit on him. He bends over too much, and his head's coming over his knee. So Jose Jr. could just reach around and just hit him behind his elbows with body shots constantly.
Jose Benavidez Jr., for folks who might remember, was able to turn pro before the age of 18.
He was like a phenom coming out. I remember when he was coming out, he was a phenom.
And had to get special permission from the athletic commission in order to be able to do it. And then, of course, a tragic incident where he was able to obviously survive and be here tonight and continue to thrive, but getting shot in the leg in 2016, changing a lot about his career after that.
Yeah, it's unfortunate.
But he has persevered, and he's trying to get back in the win column tonight after about 13 months.
He fought Terrence Crawford really good, too.
Sure did.
He gave a good account of himself that night.
And obviously he didn't win, but it turns out nobody does when they fight Terrence. Hey, so there you go.
Yeah, he went 12 rounds. I mean, when's the last time somebody been 12 rounds with Crawford?
Hard body shot, right hand.
See what I'm talking about? But the body shots, he can't sit on them because he's bent over too far. So it allows him to get around his elbow. Referee has to take charge of this fight because the back of the head shots are dangerous.
We're done now through two. This is all Jose Benavidez Jr. And honestly, if you look at the tape on Jan Janin, he's much more mobile. He's much more about activity, much more about side-to-side movement, and he's really being corralled and controlled. Look at some of the replays here. You can see him showboating a little bit, but to no avail, hard right hand sends him through, and then another uppercut on the way in.
He just simply can't defend him. The way he tries to defend him, his head's coming over too far. He should sit down instead of bending down. He's bending over, and it looks like he's protecting himself, but it allows the shots to go right behind his elbow because of the way he's sitting down. Trying to sit down on the punches, but he's not really sitting down correctly. He's just bending over.
We'll see how much longer this goes. It is scheduled for 10. And kind of interesting to note here, Benavidez, as I mentioned, coming in at 158.6 and Jan Janin at 160.6, more natural middleweight.
Curious to see if Jose Jr. could get this guy out of here. You know?
Hard to see this one going 10. I mean, famous last words, but...
What you do is when you have an overmatched guys like this, Jose Jr.
He goes down off a series of uppercuts.
Good shot. I'm really impressed if he can get this guy out of here trying to survive. And he's hurt, too. He's hurt.
He makes the count. Referee's going to let it go. There is plenty of time left in the round. More than 2 minutes. I don't think this one's going to go much longer,
folks. Going to the body again.
Look at the hand speed and combinations, Coach. As you can see from his record, Jan Janin is highly experienced, but Jose Benavidez Jr., an experienced and talented boxer.
Good body shot again.
Got to be careful about those rabbit punches.
I know.
Intentional or otherwise. Here comes Jan Janin, and he's trying.
Oh,
Benavidez just sort of content to lay on the ropes and kind of catch everything here.
I think he's looking for something. He's trying to open him up. Sometimes if you let a guy, sometimes it's easier to clip a guy when he's throwing punches than when he's kind of like shelling up when you stalking him.
Also, referee not really getting involved. Benavidez having to kind of, again, elbow block his way out to create space. And here he comes. A series of right uppercuts, and he just keeps going back to him.
Yep. Luke, that comes from Yan Yan and bending down instead of sitting down. He brings his head to you and brings his head over his front knee, so he's a sucker for uppercut and anything behind his elbows to the body because of the way he bends.
Pace for Benavidez has slowed a little bit. He eats a big left hand, kind of stumbles him back just a little bit.
Jose should finish this guy, though. With his experience, he should be good body shot. Another good body shot. He should be able to finish this guy.
Really respect how much work he's putting to the body.
Yep.
Not headhunting a guy.
Yep.
Taking his time.
Oh. Another good body shot.
We're ringside here. You can hear those. Credit to Yan Yan, and it looks like he's going to make it outside of the round. In a round, I thought for sure he was done. He will live to see round four. But that is one-way traffic if there ever has been. Jose Benavidez Jr. in absolute control here through three. If you were in the corner of Yan Yan, what would you say to him? I mean, there's only so much advice you can give a guy when they're kind of outmatched in this way.
Well, before the fight, I would have told him that's not how you sit on body punches.
Okay, but let's say he was, like, rallying you over and you had a license to go over. Look at these body shots. And again, the hand speed, the combos, didn't see any of it coming, did he?
100% he didn't. But you see how he's bending? He just simply, you just can't defend yourself right from that stance.
Also, your balance is way off.
Yes, right? Because your head's tipped over too far. You should be sitting down. You know, with your base up under you, when your head's tipped over so far, and he can't do anything offensively from there. That's why.
It's not a strong position.
Yeah, Jose can just fire at will because his instincts let him know that this guy's not going to fire with me or counterpunch me from this stance.
Touch of gloves there from both competitors. Round four between Jose Benavidez Jr. and Sladan Yanyanin.
I think Yanyanin is initiating the glove touches. Jose's a little bit meaner than that. He wouldn't touch gloves if Yanyanin wasn't trying to do that.
I'm not a big touch of gloves guy either.
Not during the middle of the fight.
Yeah, exactly. You know? When the referee's giving instructions.
Yeah.
Certainly I appreciate sportsmanship at the end.
Yep.
My least favorite is when they high-five. They should just be disqualified. Just
sometimes guys make little silent agreements when they're always touching gloves. You know, some guys use it to disarm you. You know, so you got to be careful with that. Good counter shot by Jose Jr.
Benavidez spending the last part of the last round and now part of this round, Steven, content to lay on the ropes.
Yeah, I'm confused at that, too, because he's dominating the fight. I don't know if he's trying to get a second win or what, but I'm confused why he... This is the second time that he just went to the ropes voluntarily.
Let me posit a scenario. I don't know if it's true. You tell me what you think. Is it possible he wants this fight to go a little bit longer so he can get some more rounds in, having been off for so long?
No, I think fighters say that, but I think that's game. You don't get paid for overtime. I think fighters say that when they can't get a guy out of there, but I don't believe that he's trying to carry this guy. I mean, why would he want to carry him? He punched him in the back of the head, right?
Right.
So you wouldn't punch a guy in the back of the head that you're trying to carry.
This is better. Benavidez at range scores with a left hand to the body.
He hurt him with that left hand to the body. Yanyanin is he's playing around trying to act like he's not hurt, but I don't think Jose realized he hurt him with the body shot.
Also, I like how Jose Benavidez isn't biting on some of the nonsense movement that isn't really meaningful, doesn't need to engage, kind of waits for him to stop and then attacks. Good left hand from
Jose
Benavidez Jr. sits Yanyanin down for the second time in this contest.
He just can't defend body shots. That one got to him, though. That's a good one right there. He got to go back down there immediately because it's tender down there now.
Oh, and the touch of gloves initiated one more time.
Trying to make a silent agreement.
Benavidez having absolutely none of it.
At this point right now, Jose Jr. can't accept the clinches, though, because this guy wants to survive.
And given his record, probably can if he has enough time and space to do it. Waving him on to punch the liver.
Oh, he got it. He got another one in there.
All too happy to oblige.
The way Yan Yanin is holding his hands now, Jose should rip the glove down and go around the glove. Rip the glove down because he's in some
hand trap, right?
Yep, he's pretty much in survival mode at this point.
Luke Thomas, Steven Breadman Edwards here with you on Showtime Boxing Countdown. Right now in the middle of this 10-round middleweight affair between Jose Benavidez Jr. and Slobodan Janjanin, but it is all one-way traffic. Liver shot. Where's Boz Rutten when you need him?
Man, I can't believe he got up from that one. He got all of that.
Oh, absolutely crippling him.
Yeah, he got all of it. I'm really surprised he got up.
I'll say this, Coach, for a 32-year-old Janjanin, tough guy. Tough guy. Out of Bosnia-Herzegovina.
Yeah, he's earning his money tonight. You got to respect a guy like this that doesn't come lay down. A lot of guys get hit with that same shot, and they'll just stay down, and nobody will fault them. But he's here to fight.
Let's see if there's a glove touch.
Yep.
Oh, so sure
he initiates it every round.
Round five here. And again, you look at those two losses for Benavidez. It's Danny Garcia and Terrence Crawford. Not too shabby. Not too shabby. Crowd livened up with this contest too, did they not? Coach, you got any head tattoos?
No.
No? You have any tattoos at all?
Yeah, I have a few.
I got a few as well.
Not
the
on my head.
The head tattoo is, that's a different kind of commitment.
Yeah. I don't think I'm letting anybody draw on my head.
Yeah, it's
I'm a little too old for that. These younger guys could get away with it.
People forget Jose Benavidez Jr. has been around for quite some time. Just 31.
Yeah,
just 31.
I remember him. I remember him from back in the day. He used to be a wild card. Oh, good shot in the clinch. That's good that Jose punched out of the clinch. You can't be too nice to a guy that you know, you're trying to knock out.
And this is better. He bounced off the ropes. He didn't park there.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's just going to be much more to his interests.
Only thing I don't understand is why Jose keeps retreating and going back to the rope.
Here he is again. I was just sort of saying he was doing the opposite, but
he could get this guy out of there.
To your point, he weighed in at 158.6, but doesn't look out of shape in any capacity.
No, he looks good. His body looks good. But right now, in my opinion, this is what we call playing with our food. He should go ahead and get this guy out of there. You know, he's a superior fighter. He done dropped him. He done hurt him. Go ahead and get the guy out of there. I don't understand why he's just laying on the ropes right now. Maybe he's trying to open him up for a big shot. Good shot. Good body shot. Good body shot. Good. Good body shot again.
From our vantage point, these all sound like absolute battering rams.
Good. Good body work.
It's been about, again, not quite 13 months since he fought last. So you weren't necessarily expecting the very best Jose Benavidez Jr. that you could possibly get.
I think he looks good tonight, though.
But I was just going to say, he looks, in general, pretty good.
He looks good. He looks good. He's sharp. His body looks good. He's in shape. He looks good. Only thing, and I'm nitpicking here, I just don't understand why he keeps backing up against the rope,
right,
against an inferior fighter. I don't understand why he just don't press him and get him out of here.
And he doesn't look, when they tie up as well, he doesn't look like he's the weaker guy by any stretch.
No.
He's got a bigger frame.
Yep. He's the stronger, more explosive man. So he's definitely playing with his food. But you know what? Maybe he don't want to overpush and run out of gas. You know, you never know what's going through a fighter's mind.
He might feel like he's at a stage of his career where the margin for error is a lot less than it once was.
Yep.
So take your time if you need to. And by the way, I mean, it's not like he should be pitching a shutout by this point on all the judges' scorecard. We're through five. I guess they waved it. What's happening here?
That's it?
That's it. They're waving it. The corner, I believe, decides they've seen enough. Corner threw in the towel. You know what? Good call. That one didn't need to go anymore. Slot on Yan-Yan and is visibly upset that his corner intervened on his behalf. But I have to tell you, Steven, I kind of agree with his corner. That was only going to get, you were only going to take more abuse. Why?
Yeah, those body shots were tough. Those were some tough body shots. You know, I understand why Yan-Yan is upset, though, because nobody wants to get the stoppage on their record. But his corner was protecting him. So, you know, a fighter's going to be a fighter, and the corner has to be the corner. They got two different roles. But he wanted to fight. You could tell he was here to fight.
No doubt about it. He put in a gutsy affair, but he was just technically outmatched, mm-hmm. really, kind of mm-hmm. in every way.
Mm-hmm.
Give me a grade for the performance here of Jose Benavidez Jr.
I thought he was excellent. Coming off a year layoff, on a scale of 1 to 10, I'll give him an 8. He looked good.
There it is. He looks pumped. He looks excited about getting back in here. He's got his crowd and his family here.
Mm-hmm.
They look pumped. Solid performance.
Mm-hmm.
From Benavidez Jr. here in this middleweight contest.
That was real good. That was real good. He was quick. His body looked good. He did a good job.
Yep. The corner decided they had seen enough. He's back. I wish we had an opportunity to speak to him. I don't think we will. But this is the big win for him. And he looks pumped. Let's see if they embrace, given all of the rabid punching and or trash talking.
They just did.
Yeah, there we have it.
Yep.
The two men embrace. Those two fights are down. We have one left, another bantamweight contest between Michael Angeletti and, of course, Jonathan Lopez. We'll get to that a little bit later. I wanted to talk more about our co-main event here tonight, Gary Antoine Russell of the famed Russell Brothers. There are six of them, if you can believe it. But let's talk about the patriarch of the family, Gary Russell Sr., who passed away.
Mm-hmm.
And we have already seen Gary Antoine Russell back. And, of course, Gary Russell Jr. has taken on something of that patriarch role in that gym, the Enigma Boxing Club.
Mm-hmm.
But what can that do to a fighter? How long could it take to get over not just losing your father, but losing your boxing trainer at the same time?
Everybody is different. Everybody mourns differently. I think it's a bigger effect of losing your dad because you can't replace your dad. You can't replace your trainer. I think that, you know, he just has to compartmentalize that, and, you know, everybody's different. You know, we all mourn differently. Some people do it outwardly. Some people do it inwardly. So I don't know him well enough to say that. But I think that, you know, as far as the boxing is concerned, I think he's in good hands with his brother because his brother came up under the same system. They're in the same gym. His brother's a little older. So all the things that his dad did with him, he can implement it in his younger brother. So I think he'll be okay as far as the boxing is concerned.
And he takes on Kent Cruz, has the same kind of record almost, 16-0-3, as we indicated. He's got three draws, two against one guy, both of them happening back-to-back, a split draw and then a majority draw.
Mm-hmm.
He hasn't won a fight, I believe, since 2020. It's not like he's out there losing or getting destroyed. That's really not the point. But can that play on a fighter's mind where you know you're performing, you know, ably, but you're not getting your hand raised?
Yes, it can. He's not separating himself at the level, you know, and he's brought in here tonight, you know, as a, you know, he's still undefeated, but three draws, you know, that's a lot of draws to have on your record before you even have 20 wins. So Cruz is solid, but he hasn't been separating himself at the level. So he's going to have to really, really raise his game because I think that Gary Antoine Russell is one of the best non-champions in all of boxing.
Mm. Now, there's a whole lot more we have to get to here on Showtime Boxing Countdown. Let's do this. As we mentioned earlier, everyone knows we're still in that halo off the heels of that Spence Crawford mega fight. Let's take a look at a bit of the footage from the All Access epilogue that aired on Showtime. Let's take a look.
Early drama in Las Vegas, round number 3. And Spence with a hard combination. There's another one, and now Spence going to the body. But Crawford fighting back. Both of these guys are dogs in that ring.
There you go. There you go.
Oh, damn.
Up. So Spence looking to get back into this fight.
Yeah, that definitely woke him up. He's a lot more aggressive.
You keep boxing this, okay? He's trying to steal a round from you. He's trying to push you.
Listen, EJ, how you feeling?
Yeah, good.
Listen. Don't stay on the outside.
Move your feet. Step around.
Oh, oh, the counter and the speed of Crawford on display.
Hit him! Hit him! You know what to do!
Everybody, just want to make sure you're good. You're already ready to go. I know.
Oh, man, get out of here! No, Brad!
Terrence Crawford is landing 58% of his power punches. That's a ridiculous percentage.
Against a fellow pound-for-pound stalwart, no less.
I should have bet on this.
Oh! Oh, there's a left hand that lands on Crawford.
That was the kind of punch Spence was hoping for.
There you go. Get in there.
One of the most stupendous performances I have seen in a long, long time.
Don't let him get his breath, bro.
Terrence Bud Crawford, thus far proving to be on a whole nother level.
He's desperate. None of that is working.
Don't box him. Don't fight.
Crawford's accuracy just backing up Spence with these punishing shots. And again, the counter.
Three,
just as Spence thought he landed a shot, he goes down for the second time of the fight.
Seven.
Don't let him push you, man.
Now, there's a beautiful write-up by Spence. He's trying his best offensively to get something done, but even when he lands a good punch, it's not hurting Crawford.
Not at all.
Look at his ass! Hey, Jay, use your legs. Show you right in front of me.
Oh, Spence goes down for the third time!
Weight class. Bro, I'm fighting Canelo next. I don't know what that's talking about. I'm undisputed at 154. I already did that. Come in.
Looking good, man. You beat this mother up, man. Let's go.
That jab continues to be a nightmare for Errol Spence.
Hold his head.
And again.
This fight is very close to being over.
It's okay, baby. It's okay. It don't matter. It's okay.
Final minute of the ninth. Spence desperately trying to land something of consequence. Meanwhile, the countering punches.
Yeah, it's that, baby.
And the counter right hook. The left, the right. Errol Spence on inline skates. And the referee has intervened. Mamma mia! Terrence Bud Crawford has made history. Nebraska, stand up and cheer. Terrence Bud Crawford is undisputed again.
Where are we there?
8 to 9, maybe 10.
Have a seat for a second, just for a second. Just have a seat.
Oh. Let's go down. I'm going downstairs to the way.
Hey, appreciate you.
I appreciate you.
And here, you know why? Because if it wasn't from you, this would never happen.
Yeah.
So I appreciate you for being here. You're a hell of a fighter. You already know that. I don't even got to tell you that.
Yeah.
I appreciate the opportunity.
Yeah, yeah. I appreciate
that. Love you, man. Hey, you know it's always love.
And we're back, as you can see from the all-access footage that we just aired. I mean, everyone remembers where they were when they were watching that contest. Coach, let me ask you, what was the most impressive thing about what Terrence Crawford did in that fight?
You know, great, great, great athletes, they're at their best when their best is needed. They kind of, you know, they're at their best when everybody is looking, you know, and for a guy who was yearning for the big moment, he didn't get the big pay-per-view fight till he was 35 years old, and he's been telling everybody, I'm the best, I'm the best, I'm the best. And then to put on literally a perfect fight under those circumstances, it was just like, it was breathtaking. It was like, wow, you know, because You know, there's some guys that can put on great performances. There's guys that do great things in the gym. There's guys that do it every once in a while. But to do it on that night when everybody is looking like, here is my chance, I'm coming in, I'm going to beat this guy. You guys are saying he's bigger. You're saying he's stronger. I'm gonna go across the street. I'm going to do all the things that you guys told me that I wasn't doing, and then go in there and perform like that. It was just awesome. It's one for the ages. You know, and ever you have one of those performances, and it was one for the ages. He literally fought a perfect fight.
I even said I did a post-fight show for it. I even said at the time, again, everyone's going to be different, but if anything I'd ever watched live, that's the best combat athlete performance I'd ever seen. We actually have a little bit more footage, though, we want to show you from All Access. This actually takes a look at what happens in the locker room after the fight.
Okay.
Take a look.
I told you, man! Hell yeah! It's only two of us.
What they gotta say now?
Fish fry.
I'm gonna tell you,
I'm pissed,
man.
You know how I do. I know you're pissed. You know how I'm old, fried. What I tell you in 2012?
Yeah.
So it's
pissed.
It's okay. It's okay.
Everybody's
pissed. Right there. So this is how I feel.
Don't be down on himself now.
Exactly.
Can't do that.
You gotta do that again, man. You gotta do that again, gang. You gonna do it again? You gonna do it again?
Yeah.
Hop on. Gotcha, gang.
I think you definitively put a stamp on you as the number one pound-for-pound fighter in the world after this performance.
Without a doubt, like I told everybody once before, the winner out of this fight was going to be number one pound-for-pound, hands down.
The better man won tonight. I'm not here to make any excuses. I'm a grown man. I decided to agree to the weight and get down to it, and that's what I did. So no excuses. Hats off to the champion tonight.
I wanted to thank Errol Spence and his team for me and him coming together and getting this fight underway. This is a fight that everybody wanted to see. The whole world was talking about it, and we put on a great show.
I know I'm a lot better than what I showed tonight. I'm definitely open to the rematch, and hopefully it'll be at 154 pounds.
Yep.
Congrats, man.
Yo. I got him right here.
Oh, he was
dumb.
He's dumb.
You made history tonight, Lay.
Definitely.
Woo! Woo! Woo!
Hey, y'all see that? Y'all see that?
Y'all see it.
I does it all.
There's no exact formula nor magic algorithm for transcendence. Chained, you can feel it in your bones. There are more simply nights that rise above the rest, that stamp memories in bold font and permanent ink, that grab history by the throat and demand to be remembered. Consider July 29th not one of those nights, but better than them.
Spence! Versus Crawford.
There are, after all, levels to this thing called greatness. There's the level that's cloaked in bravery, the one assumed by Errol Spence Jr.
One of the most fundamentally sound fighters in the sport.
A man who's already proven he can confront death and come back strong. There's no shame in that, an immense risk and enormous fortitude.
Good rhythm!
Then there is the level Terence Crawford reached inside a boxing ring in Las Vegas.
Drops Errol Spence!
In front of a galaxy of stars and a worldwide audience. An ascendance by transcendence.
And again, the counter!
To the highest of terrain,
making it look way too easy.
Reached only by the delusional ones.
Oh, the right hook!
Whose belief in self extends beyond reason, thrills and excites. And on the night to never forget, leaves an impression indelible and everlasting. By conquering an impossible task, laughing, smirking, and saying quite simply, it's time to go to work.
And there you saw it. Scenes from, of course, All Access after Spence versus Crawford. Now, let me ask you a question in thinking about what's next. So let's say they do that fight again at 154 pounds. To what extent does that make a difference?
It depends on how much Earl struggled to make weight. You know, we don't really know. We just assuming, you know, he didn't make the excuse for himself. But everybody's just assuming that, you know, he was flat because of the weight. So with the 7 pounds of carbs and, you know, fluids that he gets to have on his body, maybe it does. Seeing Crawford, I mean, because just being in the ring with a guy, you know, I don't think Earl underestimated him, but seeing that, like, my God, this guy, now he kind of knows what to expect. And, you know, with Crawford, you know, he fought the perfect fight. And fighting a perfect fight two times in a row is not easy, you know. So I think the fight can be more competitive. You just got to see.
Now, interestingly, as you saw some of the footage there, we had Bud Crawford kind of jawing back and forth with Jermell Charlo.
Yeah, I saw that.
Jermell Charlo, though, has his hands full. In about a little bit more than a month's time, about 6 weeks' time, he'll be in Vegas at that same venue when he takes on Canelo Alvarez. Mm-hmm. What do you make of the fight? What do you make of Jermell? I mean, risking it for the biscuit, right? Two weight classes he's going to jump up and take on a guy who is undisputed in that weight class. What's your sense of what he's attempting?
See, when we were just talking about when it depends on who you fight when you jump up, when we were talking about anyway, Jermell was one of the leading contenders for Canelo when they were both at 154 pounds. You know, so it's not like Jamel's moving up fighting David Benavidez or David Morrell, two huge 68-pounders. He's fighting a guy that he's taller than, who he's longer than, who also used to be a 54-pounder. So while the weight jump is significant and Canelo's been doing great at 168 pounds, it's not the same as fighting a guy out that started out at 168 that's huge like that. You know, like, he ain't jumping up fighting David Benavidez because it's a different fight. You know, he's not fighting David Morrell, it's a different fight. So I think that, you know, Canelo has established himself as a great fighter at 168, but I don't look at this as the same kind of huge jump as some other jumps. I think that Jermell, I know he's taller, I know he's longer, I think he's more athletic. I don't think that the weight jump is that big of a, I'm not saying it's not significant, but I don't think it's, you know, Spinks Holmes. You know, I don't think it's that. Or Hopkins Tarver. You know, I don't think it's that kind of weight jump.
By itself, that shouldn't be. Like, if he loses by itself, that wouldn't be the explanation.
Not the total explanation, okay. No. Canelo's a great fighter. He's a great fighter. When you look at him, you know you're seeing somebody that's a little different from a guy that's just pretty good. That's a great Hall of Fame fighter. He got a lot of skill. Tremendous boxer, he could do a lot of things. So Jermell has his work cut out for him from that standpoint. And plus, once Canelo moved up, I think maybe 2020, somewhere around there, he kind of like hit his peak, like at super middleweight. He hit his peak, man. You know, Canelo's one of the best super middleweights to ever live because the division hasn't been around that long. He unified the belt. He hasn't lost at the weight. He's looked great. I think he's one of the best top five or six super middleweights to ever live.
Let's talk about Canelo here for just a little bit. Now, you are the trainer to Caleb Plant, but you were not part of his training team for that particular contest, right?
I got there one fight too late.
Get
that check.
What did you learn about both men from that contest?
Canelo and Caleb?
Yeah.
I felt that Caleb could, you know, he did good. You know, and I actually think that he could do better. I think that the Caleb that showed up to fight Benavidez, I think that Caleb, and I'm not saying it because I'm in the corner, but, you know, he performed better. He gave more of himself. You know, he refused to allow himself to be stopped. He refused to to give in to David and Canelo, for as great of a fighter as he is, that's not the Canelo don't put the same kind of pressure on you that David does. The pressure that David puts on you is drowning. Is the volume of it is drowning, where Canelo is more methodical. He's probably a bigger puncher than David for one shot, but he gives you time to think. Where David is just drowning you out, you know, so it's a different fight. Plus, he's a bigger man, so he's coming downhill on you. I thought both of them fought an excellent fight. Canelo won. He stopped Caleb. You know, there's no excuses. Me and Caleb talked about the fight. But I definitely think that Caleb learned a lot from that fight. And if he ever got a chance to do it again, he will perform better.
Now, in terms of what Jermell Charlo offers as a threat to Canelo Alvarez, I mean, you look at the fights he had where he's really shined, the rematch with Tony Harrison, the rematch with Castaño. Mm-hmm. To what extent are any of those relevant in terms of what he's facing in Canelo?
Well, everything is relevant. Everything is relevant because what you're doing is you're building towards that moment. So you always draw from the experiences that you had in the past. You know, what it showed in those fights that Jermell is real good at making adjustments because he scored stoppages and both of the blemishes on his record. So they're definitely relevant. You know, just, you know, adjusted against a world-class fighter, you know, you get to draw that experience, then you take it on to the next fight. And Jermell has a clutch gene. You know, he finds a way to hit guys with his big shot. He's not like this superior boxer, like, say, like Shakur Stevenson, where he never gets touched and never loses right. a round. He's not like that.
Hardcore slickster.
Yeah, he's not like that. You know, he's not a guy that goes in like Mike Tyson and blows you out in the first round. But he's a guy that, if you watch him, you know, he may lose some rounds. And you know, the next thing you know, he hits you on the point of the chin and he knocks you out. He's a very, very clutch fighter. He's very athletic. He's very strong. He's very determined. I think he's actually more athletic than Canelo. I think he's the better athlete in the fight. I think Canelo is the more talented, better boxer as far as defensive, offensive, the moves, the punch selection, things like that. I think Canelo's more talented. But as far as just sheer athleticism, if they played different sports and pushing and pulling and moving objects, I think Jermell's more athletic than him. I think he could beat him running. And it's not a running contest, but I don't, people are looking at this fight like Jermell is so up against it. I don't feel that way. You know, I feel like that the guy that's supposedly moving up in weight, they both started out around the same weight. He's about 3 or 4 inches taller. He's longer. He's faster. He has better legs. He got less wear and tear. Canelo's always injured these days. I don't look at him as being up against it. I'm not saying I'm picking him to win. It's a tough fight. Very tough fight. And I think Canelo is a great, great fighter. But I don't look at this as like these insurmountable odds. I don't view the fight like that.
Two things that sort of stand out to me. One is, just speaking personally, the Castaño rematch is one of my favorite fights for Jermell. Because Castaño sort of makes you fight on his terms constantly. And in the second fight, Jermell met him there and then defeated him there. Really, he didn't make him fight his own fight. He kind of just accepted the duel on Castaño's terms and nevertheless persevered. Still, as good as that is, it brings me to my point, which is, what does any of that have to do with what we learned from Canelo versus Bivol, right? Like, it's one thing to beat Castaño on his terms, but can you really say that the guy who can do that can follow any kind of information that we learned from the Bivol fight, which was very different, different reality, different weight class, different size? What are the lessons there?
I don't really draw any parallels because Bivol is a amateur world champion with tremendous pedigree and a natural 75-pounder. That's all. You know, it's just different. He was just a skilled guy, but Canelo just couldn't force himself upon him. It's just a different dynamic to the fight. I think that Jermell's gonna have to raise his game because the one weakness that I think Jermell does have is for him to be an elite fighter, and I believe Jermell is probably a Hall of Famer also with his run at 154 pounds. He loses a lot of rounds. You know, if you look at the Castaño fights, the Harrison
yes.
fights, even John Jackson, I don't know if you remember that fight when he first won the title. He lost a bunch of rounds. He probably lost 7 rounds in a row before he knocked him out. Austin Trout got a majority decision.
Right.
I remember a long time ago he fought a guy named Demetrius Hopkins from Philadelphia. That was like a 115, 113 fight. For as good as Jermell is, I really don't understand why, because he's a tremendous fighter. But he just, like, he loses pretty much half of the rounds in his tough fight. And he kind of, you know, and he'll catch your time and he'll clip you. But the issue he has at this fight is Canelo has a great chin. You know, it's hard to knock
legendary
Canelo.
Chin.
Legendary chin. Canelo got, I mean, his chin can hang with anybody from any era. You know what I mean? He got a chin up there with Chavez and Hagler. Canelo takes a great shot. And, you know, if you lose in rounds against Canelo and, you know, your thing is I'll just catch this guy rhythm and clip him, that may not work with a guy that great. So, and I don't want to bring any controversy into this, but Canelo never, ever gets the short end of the stick on scorecards. You know, every fight, he always gets the benefit of the doubt. So, in my opinion, that is the bigger issue for Jermell. Him losing rounds and him depending on his big punch to knock guys out, because Canelo's a guy, man, it's hard. You know, you can hit him, but you can't hit him clean with two or three shots. You know what I mean? So that Jermell has his work cut out for him from that standpoint.
That's an interesting point as well. In Vegas, no less. I'm not sure if I've ever seen an unfavorable scorecard for Canelo Alvarez.
He hasn't got one his whole career. In his whole entire career, I've been watching him fight. And I'm not saying he's getting gifts, because he's a great fighter. But he always gets the benefit of the doubt in every single close fight. Lara, Triple G, even Floyd Mayweather, he got a majority decision. He never, ever, even Bibble, he lost that fight. It was 115, 113. And if you're looking at that fight naked eye, it didn't look like a 115, 113 fight. So that's the issue for Jermell. It's going to be very, very tough. And plus, I think Canelo is a better boxer than he is. So it's going to be tough to beat Canelo on points.
Now, the trainer of Canelo, Eddie Reynoso, said today that the plan is, you know, they're thinking ahead, but the plan is to fight Jermell, and then the plan is to fight Jermall. I don't know if you'd heard that or not, but he confirmed it today as we're speaking. I wonder what you make of that.
I just think it's great promotion. If you beat one brother, then you fight the other brother, and he beats the smaller.
It's kind of weird if one guy beats both brothers, though, right? I mean, that's a little.
I think it's all about promotion. I think that they have a built-in backstory with each fight. I think that is all about promotion, and I think it's good promotion. You create a built-in rivalry. If he beats Jermell, and then him and Jermall, they have words, and then you got the promotion going into the next fight. So I think it's actually smart. Reynoso's done a great job with Canelo's managing his career, man. Done a great job with him.
Now, you are still with Caleb Plant. Caleb Plant had his own altercation with Jermall. I'm sorry to bring it up, but it really did. I mean, it was everywhere on boxing social media.
You'll have to be sorry. It didn't. I wasn't involved.
I got to bring up the spicy topics, yeah. Red Man. An interesting thing, he addressed it on social media. I'm not here to debate the ethics of it, but rather, I got to tell you, if that's a fight that he wants, either guy wants, there is a market demand for that, no doubt about it.
Great built-in promotion, too. Yeah. I mean, you get into an altercation outside of the ring, it's great for build-up inside of the ring. I have no idea if they're going to fight or anything like that, you know, but I would love, I don't control that part of Caleb's career. What other guys I work with, like Julian, J-Rock Williams, and Karan Davis, you know, I play part in the management of their career. With Caleb, whoever he fights. You know, I'm his trainer. So when I first started training him, he literally told me that he will be fighting Darrell, Jermall, and Benavidez.
Wow.
So now he didn't know the order. So obviously he fought Darrell, obviously fought Benavidez, so I can see him fighting Jermell pretty soon. I mean, Jermall, I'm sorry. It's a great fight.
Now, in terms of the other brother, Jermell, one of the other fights that could happen within not so much this calendar year, but maybe 2024, Jermell and Bud at 154. What do you make of Bud at 154 against the guy who is currently undisputed in that weight class?
From what I saw the other night, I think he'll be
just fine.
Fine at 154. Yeah. He's man, that was breathtaking, man. I'm trying to find the right words to describe what I saw, man. It was a perfect fight.
It was a genius.
I've seen perfect fights in my life. I've seen them and I've studied them in my lifetime. And Barrera Hamed, Floyd versus Corrales, B-Hop versus
Trinidad,
Usyk versus Gassiev, Ray Leonard versus Duran, the second fight, Duran versus Ray Leonard, the first fight, Salvador Sanchez versus Wilfredo Gomez.
Today is the anniversary of his death, by the way.
Yes, that's why I brought it up. I'm a big Salvador Sanchez fan. So I've seen my share of perfect fights. Julio Cesar Chavez versus Edwin Rosario. And, you know, sometimes when you're watching it in real time and you're in a modern time, you don't really appreciate what you're looking at. But for the perfect fight, it was a perfect, perfect performance. And he did it, you know. So, man, I just you got to give credit to Errol Spence. Errol Spence is a great fighter.
He had never been knocked down at all.
That's the tough part about this fight. People don't want to appreciate what Bud did, so they're trying to discredit Spence. No. And Spence is a great fighter. I'm telling you, Errol is... I heard about Errol before I even knew him. Before I ever even met him, I heard about his reputation on the amateur scene, being a strong, walk down, mini haggler. Earl is the truth. He really is, man. And Bud just raised his game and put on a great performance.
Bud did a lot of media this week, and one thing he said was, folks were asking, well, was this your easiest fight? And he was like, no. It might look that way, but the level that Spence pushed him to get ready for it, yes, he was able to execute, but no one had ever pushed him in that way.
I'm glad he said that, man, because you got a lot of these casuals that say a lot of disrespectful things and they try to belittle fighters. And I'm glad he said that. A fight at that level is not easy. All of the punches and things that Bud had to do in the gym and the mental preparation that you need to be that good, it can stress you out. It can burn you out physically and mentally to be that perfect. And I'm glad that he said that because that gives Earl props. You know, you don't want to belittle a guy or discredit a guy that you have your career best performance on, because then what does that say about your performance? It minimizes your performance. So I'm glad that Bud was conscious enough to give Earl his props and tell the people that's not an easy fight. You know what I mean? He just made it look that way.
Well, we will come back to this conversation topic, but right now we go to our third and final fight on the prelims. Michael Angeletti taking on Jonathan Lopez, back to the bantamweight division, 8 rounds scheduled. And as you can see here in the green and blue trunks is Angeletti, the white and pink for Lopez.
I've seen Angeletti. He's very, very well conditioned. He's I don't know his trainer does all his strength work, or he has a strength and conditioning coach, but he's very well conditioned for a young fighter.
I spoke to him a couple of fights ago, and I asked him about like what he expects for X kind of challenge or Y kind of challenge. He was really adamant that his amateur pedigree basically means he can fight however he needs to, depending on whatever is in front of him.
Mm-hmm.
He had the kind of adaptability that mm-hmm. was there.
Mm-hmm. He's throwing a real good jab to Lopez's solar plexus. He's kind of like stopping him in his tracks.
So Lopez's nickname, it's in English, I would say Bum Bum. But in Spanish, it would be pronounced Boom Boom.
Oh, man.
So I think it's more like Boom Boom Mancini. They just spell it different. Remember?
There's been some good Boom Booms in boxing.
Oh. Hard right hand. Lopez, tags, man. Angeletti.
Angeletti came back with a good right hand himself. That's good.
Well, they're getting right to work here in the opening round.
Angeletti's part of the PMG management group. They have a good stable of fighters. They have him, Trayvon Marshall, the young kid Dave Whitmire that fought earlier, and Demetrius Andre.
And, of course, David Benavidez and Demetrius Andre are going to lock horns.
Oh, that's a tremendous fight.
Not too long from now.
I tell you what, Lopez, Boom Boom, he's fighting a good fight. He's right there. I thought that Angeletti would be the faster fighter, but he's matching speed with him so far.
Both undefeated, so someone's always got to go here. Two draws, though, on the record of Lopez. Angeletti a perfect 8-0-0. Good ring generalship thus far.
Yep. Angeletti has fast feet.
Wait, Lopez came to fight, though.
Yes, he did. Yes, he did. And he's finding a home for that right hand. One of the ways Angeletti could take that right hand away is if he double jabbed or he hooked off the jab, because then Lopez will have to defend with that hand, and it won't be so easy for him to throw it, because he'll be defending punches with that hand.
There was the hook you were calling for, but he's standing there trading with him.
Yep.
That's a dicey proposition. Yep.
And he's lining him up for that right hand. Angeletti has to be careful.
First round in the books. Obviously, we have a lot of boxing left to go here. 7 more rounds scheduled if it goes that long. I'm going to give the first round to Lopez. I thought he landed the more damaging shots.
Oh, I wouldn't argue. It was a close round, but he landed the two big right hands. We got a good fight.
And, of course, this is the featured prelim for us, the last one on our broadcast. It's a bantamweight showcase here today. Two bantamweight fights on the prelims, and then, of course, our main event, Emmanuel Rodriguez taking on Melvin Lopez for the vacant IBF bantamweight title. And corners giving their guys instructions. Lopez out of Puerto Rico. And Angeletti out of Spring, Texas. By the way, Lopez out of Humacao, Puerto Rico, if I'm saying it correctly. They tie up against the ropes here. Angeletti trying to be real diligent and careful how he backs out, and he does. Speaking of Terrence Crawford, Coach, one of the things that always sort of stands out about him is just how balanced he is all the time.
Mm-hmm.
You never see him fall over his own punches, ever.
You know what you can't do with Terrence? You can't speed him up. You can't make him move faster than he wants to move. You know, Earl was putting on a lot of pressure on him, but it never disorganized him. It never, like, made him frantic. He was really, really composed no matter what.
Lopez just missing on a couple of shots.
Oof. Wow.
Boy, Lopez is trying to counter.
Both of these guys are like, they're really, really, really trying to sit down right in the mid range. I can see somebody getting knocked down with the kind of shots that they're trying to land.
There's that jab hook you were calling for from Angeletti. Bit of a Philly shell there.
Yep.
You like the Philly shell? I mean, obviously it's fighter dependent, right? But
depends on the fighter. Yeah. You know, everybody can't use it. Floyd Mayweather, a lot of guys then got knocked out trying to imitate Floyd Mayweather, man. He's a special fighter, man.
Floyd makes it look effortless. Yes. Everyone's like, oh, it must be easy.
Guys get knocked out trying to imitate him. You know, he's a special fighter, and he's been doing that ever since he was a kid. And his reflexes are a lot of bit special.
Angeletti maintaining his poise here.
Good jab to the body. That's another Floyd Mayweather shot that Angeletti just put in there. Lopez, with a shoulder roll, one thing you do to counteract the shoulder roll is, instead of throwing a jab right hand hook, you throw a jab right hand and then jab. So you can go straight through the guard again, because he's sitting up there waiting for the hook to come. So his sequence is catch the jab, turn the shoulder with the right hand, and then catch the hook. So if you come right back up the middle, you'll be able to land that shot. Miguel Cotto actually did a good job of that versus Floyd Mayweather. He would throw a jab, a right hand, and then finish with like a swivel jab at the end, and he was able to hit Floyd with the last shot when Floyd was in the shoulder roll stance.
Less than 10 seconds to go here in round number 2.
Angeletti did a little better this round.
Yes. Maintain his distance a little bit better, either all the way in or all the way out.
Yep.
Both guys still very much alive and in it. Angeletti trying to find his footing, trying to find his rhythm through 2 in this bantamweight contest between undefeated 118-pounders.
This was a well-matched fight.
Certainly is.
Well-matched fight.
These guys are making it dangerous from the jump.
Yep. I thought Angeletti got his feet a little bit wet, and he did a lot better in the second round.
We'll see how Lopez kind of responds going forward about whether he's got some kind of answer. He's trying to bait, it looks like, Angeletti into some kind of exchange. And Angeletti, that was a little bit better about resisting some of that this time around. Round three coming up here from Oxon Hill, Maryland. Don't forget, 9 p.m. is when the Showtime broadcast starts with a welterweight contest between Trayvon Marshall. I know a gentleman you're looking forward to seeing.
Yes, yes. I've had him in camp about four times, man. Really good young fighter.
And Gabriel Maestre, the two-time Olympian. Here we go, round number three. And we have our clock back. Angeletti definitely trying to play the distance game here.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Angeletti's well conditioned though. I've seen him. He can keep his form and keep his sharpness the whole fight. Good turn on the right hand. Angeletti's finding something with that jab to the body.
Boy, right in the line of fire, too, just making Lopez miss. Pushing him off. Here we go.
He didn't like the shot behind the head.
Referee calling time. Yep, call, and then cites the punch behind the head there as a source of unhappiness.
Good jab to the body. That jab to the body is slowing Lopez down a little bit.
And now Angeletti much more capable of seeing what's coming at him. Yep. From some of those bigger shots.
Yep, yep. He has his radar on the right hand now. He's able to just get out of the way of it.
Pace has slowed too. It's still a good pace, but from what the frantic pace it was in round one, it's slowed a little bit.
You know what happened, Luke? Angeletti slowed him down. He's the boxer in the fight, so he's slowing him down. It doesn't benefit Lopez to stay outside and just get picked apart, so he's slowing the fight down. He has to pick the pace up. Angeletti actually did the right thing. It's better if it's one of these kind of fights for him where he's just picking and using his jab and getting to where he can get to where he wants to get in the ring now. He's calming this guy down a little bit.
Smothering that left hand there of Lopez, too, as he comes real close in contact.
So this is where, you know, sometimes these guys think they're in shape, but they really don't realize what being in shape is. Angeletti is a really well-conditioned kid, so if you're going to walk him down, you got to be in real shape. Boom Boom is, you know, he's not coming with the same ferociousness he was coming with early, and he has to keep that up if he's going to be able to deal with this guy, because Angeletti is a superior boxer, and he has a good advantage in height and reach on him.
Well, he has taken this fight by the scruff of the neck already. Yep. He's Lopez clearly fighting on Angeletti's terms right now.
Yep, yep, yep.
Boy, great timing from Angeletti. Dare I say, Coach, he's starting to pull away a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
A little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Great round for Angeletti there. Through three.
I've seen Angeletti fight twice, and he's very, very well conditioned. Very well conditioned. A lot of guys, they start out real snappy and fast and sharp, and then after a few rounds, it all, like, burns down, you know, where he can kind of keep his pace all the way through. He's very well conditioned. You could tell he's mature, man, because a lot of these guys, they don't really know what it's like to be in real shape. They think they're in shape because they get the better of their sparring partners and wherever they live at. But I can tell he's a mature kid. He gets in real shape. Lopez is actually running out of gas a little bit. He's going to have to pick it up to be competitive in this fight.
Interestingly, when I spoke to Angeletti, he told me, you know, every fighter is going to be different. Some like to have no significant other, no kids, no nothing, so they can just focus on their training. But Angeletti was the type where he felt he was lifted and raised by having kids in his life, giving him focus, giving him purpose. and kind of lighting a fire under him to make sure he moved his career along at the kind of pace it needed to. Certainly through three rounds, he has shown us great poise and skill.
That's interesting. That's interesting because sometimes that can be a distraction in the gym, and then sometimes it can, push the fighter on. It depends on the relationship he has. Good jab. Angeletti's really controlling him with his jab.
Lopez looks a little confused.
Yep. You see Angeletti hooking off the jab?
Yep.
And you know what Lopez is doing? He's keeping his right hand at home because he has to defend it. Now Angeletti's feeling himself. He has his rhythm now.
Boy, Lopez kind of grimaced after that last jab to the body.
Yep. That saps your energy. And see, he's coming, but he's standing right in front of him. He's coming. Lopez is making a silent agreement. He's coming, and then he's just stopping right in front of Angeletti. He's doing all of the work to get to him, and then when he gets to him, he just stops. As we say in the gym, don't go to him, go through him. Lopez is just, he's working to get to Angeletti, and then he's just stopping right in front of him and just allowing himself to get picked apart. He has to really, really start working.
Minute 30 left in round four here of this bantamweight tilt.
Lopez is barely throwing any jabs too, Luke.
He's starting to get picked apart here.
Yep. Good uppercut.
Lopez, though, not doing a whole lot to cut off the ring.
Nope.
Now, obviously, he's getting jabs, so that's preventing it, but...
But Angeletti's not really over-moving. Lopez is just... He has to jab his way in. There's no way he's going to be able to get in on this kid without using the jab.
Oh.
Good hook.
Split his timing brilliantly. Boy, what a fight for Angeletti. He got tested early, and he has absolutely answered.
Good body shot. Angeletti's going to start breaking him down soon.
There, right on cue.
Yep.
Sort of put combinations together in close.
He's going to start breaking him down.
Lopez looking a little frustrated. When Lopez's corner absolutely reading him the riot act in the corner with her corner advice. We are half. Whoa! We are halfway done here through four. Michael Angeletti taking on Jonathan Lopez. And it is I won't say it's a Angeletti clinic. But he is starting to shine.
He's pulling away. He's separating himself.
You can see some of these highlights here. Look at that left hook. Mm-hmm. Just fantastic timing.
And when you land in that hook off the jab, what it does is it forces you to keep your right hand at home. Remember in the first round, Lopez landed some big right hands, so now he's forcing him to keep his right hand at home. So that's a good adjustment by Angeletti.
If you were in the corner of Angeletti, what can you tell him?
Keep doing what you're doing. Keep doing what you're doing. Keep touching that body and probably go for it. It's hard to stop a guy in the last round because his sense of awareness is up, but probably go for it in the sixth or seventh round because it will really, really make a statement if he's able to get this guy out of here.
All right, here we go to the second half of this 8-round scheduled affair. And Michael Angeletti really letting everybody know what time it is. Great skill thus far.
Good jab. All the young fighters watching to see how Angeletti is sticking with his jab. He's not abandoning it. He's sticking with it. He's constantly using that jab to the head and body and making Lopez defend all areas of his body.
I'm amazed at how well he's able to catch and shoot here at times, too.
Mm-hmm. Very poised fighter.
Experience, right? That's an amateur experience. Yep. He's been in. He understands what different situations and how to manage risk. What could Lopez do here to maybe switch things up?
Lopez needs to stop trying to hit Angeletti on his chin and just hit the closest thing to him. Bang his arms. Just hit something. He keeps trying to throw the same overhand right that he landed earlier, and it's not getting there. Hit him in his arms. Hit him with more than one shot. Stop just keep trying to throw the same shot, because all he's doing is riding it with his shoulder and coming back at this point. Lopez is starting to lose a lot of steam. If Angeletti feels this, he could step on it and start pushing for a stoppage.
All the jabs forcing Lopez to reset constantly. Look how many times he just resets.
That's the problem. He's just accepting it. He has to get this guy on the inside, and he has to work. Bid on the outside right there. I mean, he has no shot at winning this fight if he does that.
On the inside, is there more Lopez could be doing?
Yes, he can. Yes, 100%. Right there, the referee was letting him work, and he wasn't worked at the clinch before they just disengaged. Like right there, he can be working.
Yeah, we didn't get to see it in Spence Crawford, but that is one of the parts of Spence's game I typically admire. His work on the inside, you'll see referees walk over to split and they end up backing off because he ends up doing it for him.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't get a taste of that against Crawford, but.
Crawford's also really good on the inside. A lot better on the inside than people realize.
But these guys keep punching a little bit after the bell. We're down here.
Well, Lopez got to figure out a way to punch while the bell in between the bells.
Exactly.
Because he's punching after the bell, but he has 3 minutes to punch while the round's going on.
And so far, it has clearly turned into an Angeletti fight. Mm-hmm. He is absolutely displaying fantastic skill, good ring generalship, good jab, to your point, good conditioning as well. Lopez is going to have to do something a little bit different here.
Look at Angeletti's posture and his body language compared to Boris in the first fight. Angeletti keeps his body language the same, keeps his posture the same, all that kind of stuff stay the same. So you're not giving the opponent the impression that you're breaking down. You're not giving the judges the impression that he's doing more to you than what he's doing. It's just it's a degree of professionalism where the guy can keep his body posture and his form throughout the fight.
You know, again, if you speak to the guy at Michael Angeletti at 27 and then Jonathan Lopez at 26, but speaking to Angeletti, he's an intense guy, focused. He's hungry. You can tell.
Good chat.
He is making Lopez miss a lot.
And he has not abandoned his jab. Good jab. Really controlling him with his jab.
Goes for a bit of a right hand. Doesn't quite score. But I think Angeletti is not far from landing something of significance here.
Well, he would have to... Either he wants to outbox him and just go ahead and get the 8-round decision. I don't know. I'm not the one in there feeling the punches. So maybe he'll play it safe because Lopez does look like he can punch a little bit. But to get the stoppage, he's going to have to start forcing himself on him a little bit. That kind of shows the degrees of where a guy is at when you have a guy outclassed and then you can go ahead on and get him out of there after you kind of get him under control.
Also, he hasn't landed anything super big. I mean, that left hook a little bit, but he hasn't landed anything super devastating by making Lopez make a mistake.
Angeletti?
Yeah.
Yeah, you're right.
It's one thing, of course, you know this better than I do, to take advantage of a mistake, but the really good guys make their opponents make mistakes and then really capitalize. Yeah, that stick to the body is fantastic.
When he's using that stick to the body, if he can bring his eyes down and either put a stick to the body and bring a right hand over the top or fake the stick to the body and bring a left hook over the top, he may be able to get something good clean in there because he's already tendering him up for it by now. Another one.
About a minute left in round six here, scheduled for 8. Oh!
Good right hand.
A pair of them land very well. For Angeletti. Oh, he's starting to cook. Starting to cook. Lopez undeterred. What a great fight.
Yeah, Lopez is showing some heart now. Good body. Angeletti landed a great left hook to the body that hurt Lopez, and he don't think he knows it. It's a big left hook to the body he just landed. Yep.
Boy,
he landed
here
a
comes,
nice left hook to the body.
Here comes Michael Angeletti.
Yep. Yep. It was a nice left hook to the body that just started it.
And he just olays him like a matador to the canvas. 10 seconds left in the round.
And he's still hurt from that body shot.
He sure is. He is avoiding.
Yep.
What a great round for Michael Angeletti, who nods at him as they separate and go back to their corners. He's feeling it, Coach.
Yeah, he is. Yeah, he is. He knows he has this guy. That was a really, really sneaky left hook to the body that he brought in there.
Let's see on the replay if we can get a look at it. Pushes him off. Gets away from him early.
That's going to come right after this. He had already landed it by now. He had already landed it by now.
Still followed up with a right hand and several shots up top. Just fantastic work from Michael Angeletti at 118 pounds. Trying to keep that pristine record intact. Remember, both of these guys are currently still undefeated. But as it stands, if this one goes to the judges, Michael Angeletti should run away with it. All right. Now our, I believe, seventh round. They're going to call time here. I guess the ringside physician is going to take a look at Angeletti. No, the corner is going to wipe off Vaseline. Too much Vaseline.
They're giving them an extra rest.
Sure are. It's an old school tactic. I'm not saying that they did it, but you know, you can throw stuff on the canvas to buy a little
way
time.
Way too long. Way too long.
All right, here we are. Round number seven of a scheduled eight-round affair, and Michael Angeletti in absolute cruise control.
Angeletti's going for the stoppage. I like his attitude. I like his attitude.
Home run right hand just misses for Angeletti.
Yeah, he went for it right there. Angeletti got to go back down to that body, though. Go back down to that body. Good body work right there.
Well, just as you said, he does exactly that.
Yep. You notice that nothing was on Lopez's return punches.
Yep.
Those body shots affecting him. Good uppercut. It's going to be interesting to see if Angeletti could get him out of here. Another good body shot.
Is there anything else Angeletti could be doing?
I think he's fighting a good fight.
About to say, he looks like he's got...
He's fighting a really, really good fight. Yep, he's fighting a really good fight. I don't like to nitpick a guy, man, because it is a fight. Some things, it looks easy, but it's not so simple just to do anything you want to do. He does have a live opponent in front of him. He's fighting really good.
Lopez landing a bit of a left hand there to the body. Oh. Great work from Angeletti. And he's trading him with him a little bit, but he's getting the better of it every time.
Yep. Lopez is doing just enough to keep himself from getting steamrolled, though. Every once in the blue moon, he'll come back with a big counter hook to keep him, to keep Angeletti honest. Good uppercut. Good uppercut.
Angeletti with a monster uppercut. Yep. Well timed.
Yep. Really good uppercut. Really good shot.
A I'm loving how Angeletti can instinctively switch from high hand guard to Philly shell. Exactly where he is, what he
and
wants to do.
And he's pressing the fight now. He's pressing the fight now. Right. But before he was boxing, now he's pressing the fight.
He had spent the majority of the fight, as you indicated, on the back foot, doing fine at it. But now he's trying to press the action. One round left in our final fight on the prelims here between Michael Angeletti and Jonathan Lopez. Luke Thomas, Stephen Breadman Edwards here joining you from Oxon Hill, Maryland, the National Harbor, MGM National Harbor. A beautiful facility, if I do say so myself. I'm going to make the Philly guy compliment DC. That's what I'm going to do. I'm going to get one out
of
you.
I like DC.
All right, very good.
I like DC.
Actually, you know what? I like Philadelphia.
I got a lot of good boxing colleagues from the DC area. I love this area. I actually hire a lot of sparring from this area to drive in, you know, spar from my guys. Yeah, I have no issue with DC at all.
My only issue with Philly is that Flyers fans are bums. I just want them all to know that, okay?
I'm not a big hockey
fan. All right, very good.
So
all right.
We'll handle issues out of that.
Here we go. Eighth and final round. If Lopez is going to do something, it's going to have to be by stoppage. Otherwise, he is going to lose on the cards, in all likelihood anyway. Michael Angeletti.
I like Angeletti's attitude. I like his attitude. He know he has this fight won, and he's trying to make a statement. I respect that. He's not trying to play it safe. You got to be careful of that left hook, though.
Yeah, Lopez not out of it.
Nope.
Outmatched,
nope.
But not
nope.
Out.
Nope, he's still game. Angeletti, in the midst of him trying to get this stoppage, he can't abandon the body, though. He still has to go back down there.
Lopez's corner actually employing him to put a little bit more steam on his punches.
Well, it's the last round. He got to sell out if he wants to win. he can't. He don't have any reason to be saving it after this round. Angeletti is a slightly built guy, but he seems physically strong.
Right. Also well balanced, just in terms of his stance, his pace, his movement.
The strangers are doing a good job with him.
Getting back to that Crawford Spence fight, that's one thing when you watch Crawford, when he locks up, he always puts himself in mechanically advantageous positions to maximize whatever strength that he has.
And that comes from not allowing anybody to make a move faster than he wants. Crawford is fast, but it's a smooth fast. He takes his time with everything he does. He doesn't allow himself to be rushed. That's a gift that very few athletes have. Like a guy like Amir Khan, he was fast, but you could force Amir into mistakes. You can make him make mistakes. Well, Crawford, you're going to have to just, good body shot.
Lopez is visibly hurt. He's got a good poker face.
Remember I told you he got to stay down to the body. People think they can't go to the body in the late rounds, but this is actually the best time to mix it down there.
You absolutely get it. Everyone always says it's investment for later in the fight.
You go to the body the whole entire fight.
Yeah, color me impressed, Coach. This has been a phenomenal showing for 27-year-old Michael Angeletti.
Angeletti's doing good, real good. And he's still going for it, too. He's getting a little right hand crazy, though. I would like to see him bring a hook back if he can.
About 20 seconds left in this affair. Here comes Lopez marching him down.
Lopez definitely don't want to get stopped.
Whew.
Lopez is game. I give him credit. He's game.
He certainly has tried to win through the entirety of it.
Yeah, he did.
But probably just a bit outmatched.
Yeah, I think Angeletti won every round except for the first.
So we'll wait for the judges' scorecards here in Maryland, Oxon Hill, Maryland, just outside Washington, D.C. for our final fight here for Showtime Boxing Countdown. As a reminder, 9 p.m. in the East, we switch everything over to the live television broadcast for the main card, which we'll talk about as soon as we get the judges' decision here in this Angeletti and Lopez bantamweight contest. Angeletti's going to, I think, turn some heads with that performance, yeah? Going to get some people's attention, I think.
Oh, he's already had my attention. I've seen this is my third time watching him fight. He can fight. And in these divisions, you don't need 20, 25 fights to break through and get a title shot. He's already 27. He already has the pedigree. We're in 2023. By the end of next year, he should be ready for a title shot. Especially with the monster moving up, division should be wide open.
Right. In fact, we're going to be crowning an IBF champion here tonight.
Yes.
Between Emmanuel Rodriguez and
four belts opening up so that's a lot of belts.
Grand opportunity. You know, it's always great when someone unifies, but when they reset and then the division's wide open, it creates that vacuum, creates some fun, interesting matchups along the way.
A lot of parity after a great fighter moves
for
up.
For sure. You got a lot of friends in attendance?
Yeah, that's Michael Angeletti's manager right there.
Ah, okay.
Yep.
He's got to be happy with his guys.
Yep, that's the guy, Peak Management Group.
Ladies and gentlemen, after 8 rounds of boxing, we go to the judges' scorecards. Judges Brent Bovell and Bill Clancy both saw it 79-73. And Judge Sharon Sands sees it 80-72. Wow. All three judges in agreement for your winner by unanimous decision. And still undefeated, Michael Angeletti.
Well, there you have it. Michael Angeletti defeating Jonathan Lopez on the scorecards, two scores of 79-73 and then a rout 80-72.
That was about right.
That's about right. You can either give Lopez the first round or none at all.
Yep. It's either 7-1 or 8-0.
So let's reset here if we can. In terms of our prelim fights, they are done. My name is Luke Thomas. I'm one half of the Morning Combat podcast. My co-host Brian Campbell's on vacation. So here I am in Oxon Hill, Maryland, with the genius himself, Philadelphia's finest, Stephen Breadman Edwards. Let's talk a little bit about our main card that's coming up at 9 p.m. We were just talking about the bantamweight division. We had two bantamweight fights here. We're going to have a bantamweight fight in the main event when Emmanuel Rodriguez tries to reclaim that IBF title against Melvin Lopez, a southpaw who just hasn't – he's a good fighter, but he hasn't fought the – for sure I can say this. Emmanuel Rodriguez is by far his toughest opponent. And a guy, as we indicated at the top of the broadcast, was already a champion in this weight class.
I'm very impressed with Emmanuel Rodriguez. I saw his fight with Gary Antonio Russell in October of last year at the Barclay. And that was one of the best displays of using a counter right hand against the southpaw I've seen in a very long time. I was really impressed. He had like a radar. He must have landed the same shot maybe 25, 30 times throughout that fight. I was in the back locker room watching him, and he's improved from, you know, when he lost to Inouye. But Inouye kind of does that to everybody, so it's hard to judge a guy on a great fighter like that. But I'm very impressed with Emmanuel Rodriguez. I expect him to do great tonight.
And so remember, he had lost to Inouye, and then he had that loss, but extremely controversial loss, to Raymart Gabalo, where most observers thought that, in fact, Rodriguez had won. Mm-hmm. And then he had the rematch against Gary Antonio Russell. And to your point, there were some questions. Okay, how's he going to look? Blah, blah, blah. He looked great up until the head clash.
Yep.
He looked great. Yep. So we'll see how that one goes in the main event. Again, one more time for the IBF vacant bantamweight title. Your co-main event is the other Gary Russell. Well, there's many Gary Russells, but this one.
Antoine.
Gary Antoine Russell, undefeated 16-0, taking on Kent Cruz, who is also 16-0. But let's just say this again. This is clearly the toughest opponent of Kent Cruz's career.
Oh, Gary Antoine Russell, I mean, he's one of the, him and Jerron Ennis, in my opinion, are the best non-champions in boxing. Guys who've never won a belt, never had a chance for a belt. Those guys, he's a phenomenal fighter. He could be the best fighter at 140 pounds, and we don't know it because he just haven't had his, you know, his shot yet. So Kent Cruz has his work cut out for him tonight because Gary Antoine Russell, he has everything. He has the physical strength. He's a big puncher. He's a southpaw. He has the pedigree. He was an Olympian. He has the talent. Like I said, he reminds me of a mix between James Kirkland, who was a ferocious fighter about 15 years ago, man, and Sean Porter. That's If I could mix two fighters together, that's who I see with him.
I will say this, and I mean this just as a DC guy and a boxing fan. Mm-hmm. If I do have a criticism of the Russell brothers, it's just inactivity. I would just like to see them compete more.
You know what, though, Luke? I don't think fighters control their activity. You know, that's just...
At all?
They do to an extent, but, I mean, look, okay, put it this way. When you fight, you get paid, right? So wouldn't you want to get paid as much as you can, as often as you can? So, I mean, some fighters opt to say, you know what, I don't need to fight, you know, or whatever. But a guy like Antoine Russell, I don't know if he controls his inactivity. Sometimes it's just the way the schedule falls and the opponents aren't around and, you know, everybody makes a different amount, so you got to put certain guys on certain cards. So it's a lot of logistics that go into it. But every young fighter that I know older fighters who don't like fighting often, but the young fighters, they want to fight. So this guy has never won a world title. I'm going to assume he's never made seven-figure payday. He's only 16-0. I would assume that he wants to fight. You know what I mean? I just don't, you know, it's just how the logistics of today's era goes.
And in fairness to him, this fight was supposed to happen in May. It got canceled.
Okay.
So this is the rebooking of it.
Yeah.
Here we are here now in August. Now, one fight we haven't discussed, by the way, the Gary Antoine Russell and then Kent Cruz fight, that'll be super lightweight. We now go to the opening bout on the main card at 9 p.m. on Showtime. A gentleman who I know you're interested in, Trayvon Marshall, taking on Gabriel Maestre. Now, Gabriel Maestre, interesting. This guy spent an enormous amount of time in the amateurs, a two-time Olympian for Venezuela, now out of Barranquilla, Colombia. What do you know about Trayvon Marshall? What stands out to you about him, and what is he up against with this guy who's got a significant amount of amateur experience?
I'm a big, big Trayvon Marshall fan. I got some good friends that's a part of his management group. His trainer, Andrew Council, is one of the most underrated trainers in boxing. You know, we get along really good, and I've had him in camp for Julian Williams and Karan Davis four different occasions. So he's a tough kid, man. He can fight. He has a total package. He just needs a little bit more seasoning. You know, and experience is something you really can't rush on a guy. It kind of has to get cultivated, you know. So he needs a little bit more seasoning with little things. But he can fight, man. He kind of reminds me, he has a little bit of Tony Harrison in his game, a young Tony, a little bit of Julian Williams in his game. He can fight. He's tall, but he likes to bang. He has a big variety of punches. He has a fighter's mentality, so when you hit him, he tries to get you back, which creates for exciting fights. I'm looking forward to seeing his progress in the welterweight division. I think that he has a shot to be a world champion. I'm not saying he's going to be a world champion, because you never know how that works once you get to that level. But I definitely think that he has a shot to be a world champion in maybe 2-3 years.
Now, what's interesting is he said 147 is about to be wide open. Of course, if Spence and Crawford move up to 54, we still know Boots is around. There's some other bigger names. I wouldn't want to rush Trayvon Marshall just yet, but do you agree with the general idea that 147 is about to be wide open?
I don't know about wide open, because I think Jerron Ennis is a phenomenal fighter. And if he gets the opportunities, I think that, you know, it looks like Crawford and Spence will probably vacate and move up. And I think that Ennis will be next in line. So he could kind of hold the division down with an iron fist. But Ennis is about 4 years older than Martin. So, you know, although, you know, they can fight, I think that they're at two different stages of their career right now.
Now, let's talk about this before we get out of here. Again, one more reminder, 9 p.m. in the East, in about 19 minutes or so as we speak, the production will go live on Showtime for the broadcast right here from the MGM National Harbor in Oxon Hill, Maryland. There is going to be a Canelo press tour, a Canelo Charlo press tour next week. There'll be a Tuesday and a Wednesday press tour. I believe Tuesdays is in New York. I believe I have that right. And then Wednesdays will be in L.A. Of course, they did that with many other fights, including Spence Crawford and including Tank and Ryan Garcia. Good to see that. I like press tours. Do you? Caleb and Canelo had a bit of a dust-up in the L.A. one, but in general, I'm a big fan of these.
Caleb and David had a little dust-up, too, at one in L.A. I mean, it's good for the promotion. As your trainer, to be honest, it's a pain in the butt, because you got to break camp, and you lose about 2 days of work when you got to go on the press tours because of the traveling, it fatigues you, it dehydrates you, you can't train those days. So for trainers, a pain in the butt, but for the media and the casuals, they love all of the back and forth. But as a trainer, I'm not a big fan. I'll show you an example. The press tour with for Caleb and Darrell, we flew all the way to New York from Vegas camp to do the press. You know, the plane got delayed. Caleb, not only did we miss that day of work, we missed the next day of work because the plane got delayed so much.
Oh.
We didn't get in until late at night. You know, Caleb was tired. He came back to the gym sluggish. He wasn't feeling that good. So for the fighters, it's a pain in the butt. You know, yeah, but for the fans and the media, they love that stuff.
And yet, Caleb still won in dramatic fashion.
Yeah, he did. But I'm telling you, that was a, you know, we had to like really, really pull our resources that camp. You know, he just wasn't feeling well from going back and forth, traveling, being stuck at the airport all day. It was tough on him.
I can understand that. Well, nevertheless, Canelo, an experienced fighter, certainly you could say Charlo as well. They'll be ready when they lock horns on September 30th. But Tuesday and Wednesday, keep it locked right here on the Showtime Sports YouTube channel for broadcasts of both of those. My colleague, Brian Campbell. Do you know Brian Campbell?
Yes.
Yes. He'll be hosting those, I believe, with some other big. I think El Diamante is going to be on those broadcasts.
Okay.
Well, Raul Marquez and many others. If the folks want to get more of the Stephen Breadman Edwards experience, how can they get it?
You already told them. Maybe a little Twitter. You know, I go on there about twice a week, talk a little stuff, and then, you know, I'm out.
Very good. If you want more from what I do, you can follow me on Twitter as well, at L Thomas News. And, of course, I do the Showtime-produced podcast, Morning Combat, all things combat sports, boxing, MMA, and a whole lot more with Brian Campbell. We do that Monday, Wednesday, Friday, live 11 a.m. in the East, and then we travel to shows like this. But I think we are done here from Oxon Hill, Maryland at National Harbor, 9 p.m. Don't forget, is when the broadcast starts for the eventual main event between Emmanuel Rodriguez, Melvin Lopez. They're going to crown a new bantamweight champion here tonight in the for the IBF. For Stephen Breadman Edwards, I am Luke Thomas. Thank you guys so much for watching. We will catch you next time. And until then, enjoy the fights.
These four brothers are our last hope to save the world.
Whoa. Cool.
No, not cool.
A bit cool.
You can't stop us.
What?
Ice Cube. John Cena, Seth Rogen.
What you looking at, bro?
Yeah, bro, what you looking at?
Jackie Chan, Rose Byrne, Post Malone, Maya Rudolph, and Paul Rudd.
I like his vibe.
I like your vibe.
I like your vibe.
I like your vibe.
Now playing in theaters. Rated PG.
All right, everybody ready? Go!
Thursdays and Sundays on CBS.
Buckle up, because it's going to be a long season.
The battle is on as CBS Reality Titans.
We are the strongest force in this game.
Team up with MTV Challenge Legends.
People are coming for blood, and it's going to get ugly.
Who will become?
What y'all are very good at is lying to people's faces.
America's Challenge Champion.
The Challenge USA. New Thursdays and Sundays on CBS.
I'm kind of like an animal that looks for his prey. I am the toughest opponent that he has ever faced.
Back with a vengeance. It will be one heck of a night. We start in the welterweight division. Trayvon Marshall takes on Gabriel Maestre, the co-main. The battle of unbeaten. Gary Antoine Russell taking on Kent Cruz. And then, of course, the capper. The main event for the IBF bantamweight title. Emmanuel Rodriguez taking on Melvin Lopez.
This is a hurt business. Someone old got to go.
I love fighting southpaws. I'm going to shock the world, man.
Back in my hometown, it's almost like I'm representing my area.
I think it's going to bring the best out of me. I feel like he got more pressure than me.
Pressure makes diamonds.
He wants it. I want it. We are going to just throw for the world title. He may have the 7 stoppages, but none of those 7 were me. Talking is cheap. I'm going to prove why I can be one of the best at 118. I guarantee you that I'm going to come out with the win. It will be sending a message to the other champion of the division that I'm here to stay.
Our official weigh-in for tomorrow's exciting night of boxing. 146.6 for El Capitan. 146.8 for Marshall. 142.6 for Cruz. 138.4 for Russell. This is our co-main event. 117 for Lopez. 118 for Rodriguez. We have a world championship bout. Live on Showtime.
Hey.